Seven of spades. Ten of spades. From dummy, the queen of spades.
Well, I can't follow suit, so I discard the six of diamonds.
Mm-hmm. Our trick. From dummy, the ace of spades.
Queen of diamonds.
Eight of spades. And there goes my king of spades, losing to your ace. Our trick. From dummy, the two of spades.
Well, I can't follow suit, so what was my master ace of clubs goes down the drain.
I'll discard the five of clubs. And I can't follow suit either. So your miserable two of spades wins the trick for you.
So, four hearts, bid, and made. 120 points below the line gives us game and rubber.
I was banking on that queen finesse working, and thank heavens it did.
Well done, partner. Oh, I'm sorry, I hope you didn't manage just finishing that hand, but of course, that is the thing about bridge. It would take nothing short of an earthquake to break up a tricky hand in play. If you already play whist, you may have followed the gist of what was happening just then. If not, then all this mumbo-jumbo about dummy finesse, game and rubber, not to mention four hearts, bid and made, when we haven't even seen a heart card, may well have convinced you that bridge is the most difficult game in the world and you'll never get the hang of it. Well, you'd be wrong. Now, I'm going to assume that you're a novice, that you know nothing at all about the game of bridge, but you have seen one of those before, a pack or a deck of cards. Now, there are 52 cards in the pack, and they are divided into four suits. First of all, you have spades. Then you have hearts, diamonds, and the fourth suit is clubs. Jokers, we don't want to know about. There are 13 cards in each suit. Aces are high. Then you've got king, queen, jack, ten, right the way down to the miserable little two, which can still take a trick, as you saw in that first hand. Bridge is a partnership game for four players, and the partners sit opposite each other. So Tessa is my partner, and we are playing these two little rogues here, Amanda and Peter, who are also playing in partnership. Now, partnerships can be decided by natural selection. That is, husband and wife say, that's not always a very good idea. Or mum and dad versus the youngsters, or simply the two best players teaming up with the lesser mortals. But to stick strictly to the rules, we should each of us cut a card. And the two highest cards play against the two lowest. And the highest of all is the first to deal, because we fixed it that way just to demonstrate Tessa and I are partners against Amanda and Peter. And Tessa is the first one to deal. Right, stage one, the deal. Opponent on the dealer's left thoroughly shuffles the pack. There you go. And just to make sure all is fair and above board, her partner cuts the pack. And Tessa starts the deal. One card at a time, to each of us in a clockwise direction. We play with two packs of cards, different colours. We've got red and blue. And while Tessa is dealing, I'm busy shuffling the next pack, preparing it for the next deal. Now, once we have got our 13 cards, we come to stage two, the first exercise in skill, the bidding. As you saw at the beginning, a card was played from each hand in turn, and the highest card of the suit first played won the trick. So there are 13 tricks to be won. And we bid against each other to decide the contract, the highest contract, in other words, which partnership thinks it can win the most tricks. Now, to do that, it must take at least seven tricks, obviously. That's one more than the highest equal division of 13, six and six. So we discount the first six tricks. We call that the book. And the bidding starts at one. Now, each bidder has the right to choose the trump suit, and any card in the trump suit will win against any card in the other three suits. So, if I bid one spade, I'm saying that between us, I think that my partner and I could win seven tricks, providing spades are trumps. Well, obviously, the bidding can rise from one up to seven to Grand Slam level. And it can also rise within each level from suit to suit. Poor old clubs are the lowest. They're outranked by diamonds. Then come hearts, which in turn are outranked by spades. Easy to remember because if you go from the bottom up, they're in alphabetical order, C, D, H, S. Now, only one bid outranks them all, and that is a bid of no trumps. The bidder is saying that he is prepared to make the contract without any suit being chosen as trumps. Right? Well, the best way to learn bridge is to play it. You know enough now about the basics of the bidding to join in our game as an observer, so feel free, wander around the table and observe. My partner Tessa dealt. The bidding runs clockwise with the dealer having had the first chance to bid.
Although they're not high numbers, I have got six hearts, which means that there are seven more out against me, but my partner should have some. So, if I bid hearts, and of course the trump suit does beat all others, how many of the 13 tricks could we make? I should make a trick each with the ace and the king of clubs, and then being void of clubs, could trump in whenever I wanted, if I needed to. The ace of diamonds should win us another trick. And if the king of diamonds is well placed, in other words, on my right in Peter's hand, then I may be able to finesse the queen as I did in the last hand, and she'll make a trick on her own. If the other seven hearts are fairly evenly spread, three rounds should draw them out. So I think we could make seven tricks. The first six, the book, don't count. So I reckon I can afford to bid one heart.
So, length in spades. Five to the queen. And with spades outranking hearts, I wouldn't need to raise the bidding to the two level. But even so, my hand is simply not strong enough to enter the bidding at this stage. Perhaps my partner will be able to, but for the meanwhile, I shall say, no bid.
Well now, partner opened the bidding with one heart. Opponent number one passed. What should I bid? Well, I've got three hearts, which is the suit my partner bid. Four diamonds to the King Jack. Only problem is that to bid diamonds, I'd have to raise to the two level, as diamonds rank below hearts. And that could give the impression that I'm stronger than I am. What else have I got? My hand is balanced, no singleton, one of a suit, or voids, none of a suit. So there is one bid that will reflect just that and keep us at the one level, and tell my partner that I'm not exactly loaded.
One no trump.
What a pity. Here I am with a hand strong enough to open the bidding, but with my partner having passed and our opponents up to one no trump, I'm not strong enough to enter the bidding at the two level. I could make the ace and king of spades and the queen of hearts once the king has driven out the ace, but I still have no suit long enough to choose as trumps.
No bid.
The remaining high cards must be fairly evenly divided, as our opponents haven't entered the bidding, and Shaw's limited response of one no trump to my one heart opening means he isn't exactly sitting on a powerhouse either. So, how do I stand? Six hearts to the nine, and doubletons in spades and clubs. In other words, two cards in each suit. And as the bidding stands at the moment, we're committed to making seven tricks in no trumps. Doesn't make sense, does it? Far better to have hearts as trumps, which gives even the low hearts more power, as they could trump spades after two rounds. So I'll bid
two hearts.
No bid.
And that is a minimum limit bid if ever I heard one. Takes me out of my one no trumps bid with a simple rebid of her own suit. So what she's really saying is, I've got minimum values and not too balanced a hand, so we'd be better off with hearts as trumps. Then we stand a good chance of making a contract of two. Eight tricks, in fact. Well, who am I to argue?
No bid. No bid.
And three no bids in a row ends the bidding. A contract has been entered into, and we are about to play a hand in which we must make at least eight tricks with hearts as trumps, and our opponents would do their darndest to stop us from doing so. But before we move into the third stage of the game, playing the hand, did you get a feeling for the bidding? Well, certainly there were a few bridge terms there you would have picked up. Doubletons, singletons and voids. Two of a suit, one of a suit and none of a suit. All very useful in a suit contract, as one can do some trumping. Well, surely you will say, someone must have worked out a more accurate method of evaluating your hand than the woolly way we've just demonstrated. Well, of course, several people have. And one of the best methods is the point system. As you know, a trick is won by the highest card in the suit first led. Unless, of course, it's trumped, because any card in the trump suit beats all cards in the other three suits. So, two factors affect the strength of your hand. How many high cards you hold, and the distribution. After all, there are only 13 cards in each suit. So if you hold, say, seven clubs, there can only be six more clubs divided among the other three players. Now, if we give a points value to these two factors, it'll give us a yardstick by which to measure the strength of our hand. This has got nothing to do with the scoring. The point system is simply a way of judging whether or not your hand is strong enough to bid and how many tricks you can expect to win. The top five cards in any suit are called honours. That's the ace, king, queen, jack, ten. Now, if we give the top four a points value, four for an ace, three for a king, two for a queen, and one for a jack, we can start to do a little addition and decide whether or not we have a better than average hand. There are 10 honours points in each suit, so obviously there are 40 in the whole pack. Divided between four players, the average hand must be 10 points. Now, what was the other factor? Right, distribution. The more cards you have in one suit, the less are divided between the other three players. 13 cards in a suit, so the average holding for each player must be three, with one left over. So to hold four puts you just above average. And in the play, holding five or more of a suit means that even the lowest card of your long suit stands a good chance of taking a trick when the other player's holdings of that suit are exhausted, particularly if that suit is trumps. So in our point system, we can add 1 point for every card held over and above the first four in any one suit. And these are known as distribution points, as distinct from honour points. And that's enough to be going on with. There are one or two other points valuations to guide us for things like singletons or voids, but don't let's confuse the issue with too much information at once. It's much better to try a little practical valuation for yourself. So feel free to wander around the table and once again tune in to the thoughts on the hands we've just bid. But this time, with the point system in mind.
40 honest points in the pack altogether. Let's see how many have come my way. Four honors. Ace king of clubs and ace queen of diamonds. Four for an ace, three for a king, and two for a queen. So, two aces make 8 points, plus a king, 11 points, plus a queen. That totals 13 points. 13 from 40 leaves 27 points between the other three players. That averages out at 9 points each. Now, if, and it is only if, my partner has an average holding, we have 22 points between us, just over the halfway mark. So out of 13 tricks, we should make 7. Any distribution points to add? Well, yes, long suit of hearts, 6 altogether, so I can add 2 more distribution points. Obviously enough points to open the bidding, but do I have a biddable suit? Yes, my 6 hearts. Now let's see. A biddable suit is one with 4 cards headed by an honour, or one with 5 cards or more. 5 or more of a suit, irrespective of any honours, is a re-biddable suit, which means I could bid hearts again without partner supporting me. So, 1 heart.
An opening bid of 1 heart must mean that Tessa has at least 13 points. That's honours plus distribution.
The bidding's been opened, so I'm not restricted to 13 points. But I must have a very strong suit, and I have spades, 5 to the queen. And there's one distribution point there. +2 for the queen, 4 for the ace of hearts, and 1 for the jack. 8 total points. But with an opening bid already out against me, while it's enough to respond if my partner opens, it's certainly not enough to enter the bidding on my own account. No bid.
My partner has opened one heart. And, as I know at this stage, she can have anything between 13 and 19 points and a minimum of 4 hearts. Well, how many possible tricks can I offer her? Now, how many honours points have I? 1, plus 3, plus 1, plus 2, that's 7. And no distribution points. 7 points, well, that's only 2 tricks. And if partner opened on a bare 13 points, she only has about 4 tricks. That's 6 tricks between us. Just the book. But I must keep the bidding open. I have a biddable suit in diamonds, 4 to 2 honours. But with diamonds ranking below hearts, that would mean taking it up to the 2 level. And it'll give the impression I'm stronger than I am. Wait a minute, there is a bid open to me with this hand, which tells my partner I have 6 to 9 points.
One no trump.
Oh, partner, no bid from you. What a pity. Because here I am clutching 13 honest points, enough to open the bidding, but not enough to overcall our opponents without a long suit. Oh, well, there's only one thing for it.
No bid.
A limited response from Shaw, showing 6 to 9 points and no biddable suit in spades, or he'd have bid them at the 1 level. Now, what have I got? A doubleton in spades with no high card for protection, and only 2 clubs. True, they are the ace and king, but if I played this in hearts, I could trump the 3rd round of spades and clubs if I had to. I think this hand would play better in hearts than in no trumps. At least I've got 6 hearts.
2 hearts.
No bid.
No bid.
No bid.
And 3 no bids in a row ends the auction. And my partner and I are in a contract of 2 hearts. 8 tricks to be won with hearts as trumps. As my partner was the one to bid hearts, she becomes the declarer and plays both our hands. I become the dummy. What does dummy do? Well, relax, make the tea, pour the drinks, or just sit and watch the hand being played. But I think on this occasion, I'll use the time just to recap on your introduction to bridge and remind you of the points we've covered and some of the phraseology that went with them. Evaluate your hand by using the point system. Honours points, 4 for an ace, 3 for a king, 2 for a queen, and 1 for a jack. Distribution points, 1 point for every card of more than 4 in a suit. You need between 13 and 19 points to open the bidding with 1 of a suit, and 13 or 14 points plus an evenly balanced hand to open 1 no trump. To respond to an opening bid of 1 of a suit by your partner, you need a minimum of 6 to 9 points. But if you need to go to the 2 level, because of the rank of the opening suit, for instance, if your partner opened 1 heart and you wanted to respond with diamonds, you can't bid 1 diamond, you've got to go up to 2 diamonds. Well, then you need a minimum of 9 points. If you consider that roughly 3 points in your hand should take 1 trick on the table, you'll see the sense of it. Because at the 1 level, you are offering your partner 2 tricks. But at the 2 level, you need to offer 3 tricks. The next requirement for opening is a biddable suit. That's any 4-card suit headed by an honour, ace, king, queen or jack. Or any 5-card suit or longer, which is known as a rebiddable suit. That's one that you can bid more than once, whether your partner supports it or not. But most important is a sound rebid. This is a suit you can bid second time round after your partner's response. If you've got a rebiddable suit of 5 or more, well, that's fine, you can rebid that. Or it could be a second biddable suit, that is, 4 to an honour. But either way, the sound rebid should be there. A limit bid. Now, this is one we didn't fully define before. I made one in response to my partner's opening of one heart. I responded, one no trumps. It puts a limit on the total number of points that I hold. It is telling my partner that I hold between 6 and 9 points and no more. You'll recall, in fact, that I had 7. My partner also replied with a limit bid, a simple rebid of her own suit, 2 hearts. And she was saying, I'm within 2 points of the minimum required for an opening bid. The minimum is 13, and she had 15. So, no trumps and a rebid of your own suit are limit bids, showing points holding within limits. 3 no bids in a row ends the bidding, and the hand is played by only one of the partnership that made the highest bid. That player is called the declarer because he or she was the first to declare the suit or no trumps in which the contract is being played. Meanwhile, will my partner make the 2 hearts she bid? Opponent to the left of the declarer leads.
And that's me. The opening lead is nearly always the most difficult, because until I've made it, we don't know what's in dummy. A good lead is top of a sequence of touching honours, such as Queen from Queen Jack 10. But I don't have one. I have Queen 10 in spades, but they're not touching. Another lead is fourth highest of the longest suit, and that seems to be the best with my holding. 1, 2, 3, 4.
The 6 of spades.
And I now put down the dummy hand in front of my partner for everyone to see. Trumps, first of all, on her left, on my right. Then the rest of the hand. There we are. And now Tessa gets her first opportunity to judge whether our bidding has landed us in the right contract. She can now take her time to plan her strategy. And it's up to Declara to work out just how the 2 hands fit and just which trick can be won or lost by each hand.
Oh, those diamonds are handy. No losers with ace, king, queen, jack between us. And no club losers either, as we've got the 3 top honours. Oh, it looks like we're going to lose 2 spades straight away. But only 2, as I can trump the 3rd round. So it all depends on how the trumps are divided. Only 1 honour between us, the 10. But with a holding of 9 of the suit, we should soon draw the remaining 4. If we're lucky, they'll be divided 2 and 2. If we're really unlucky, and all 4 are with 1 opponent, we'll only make 2. But that's well against the odds. Anyway, right now, I have to follow suit.
From dummy, 5 of spades.
King of spades.
2 of spades.
King of spades wins. Our trick. You to lead, partner.
Ace of spades.
4 of spades.
3 of spades.
From dummy, 9 of spades.
Ace wins. Still your lead, partner.
8 spades fallen so far, 5 to go. I've got 1. There's still 1 in dummy. And as Amanda's played 4th highest and then a lower card, she must have started 5 to the queen. Dealer can't have any. Well, I think my safest play is a 3rd round of spades.
8 of spades.
Good. Both of my spades have gone. Now, I can't follow suit anymore, but I can trump with a small heart, which should win the trick.
2 of hearts.
7 of spades.
And from dummy, the jack of spades.
Right. I won that trick by trumping. And now I have the lead, I can start to draw their teeth. In other words, start to set up my trump suit. Four honours are out against me. Ace, king, queen and jack. But with luck, their distribution will be two each. So, if I lead trumps twice, I should only lose two tricks. Well, here goes the first one. Three of hearts.
Jack of hearts.
And from dummy, the four of hearts.
The distribution is against us. How sickening. I'm sitting here with a king and queen of trumps. My partner's jack would have taken the trick. I'd have no choice. I have to follow suit and take the trick with my queen.
Queen of hearts.
Queen wins. You to lead, partner.
But what do I lead? Diamonds or clubs? Well, dummy has strength in diamonds, so there's not much hope of taking any tricks in that suit. So, clubs it must be.
Five of clubs.
Ace of clubs.
Two of clubs.
And from dummy, the four of clubs. Ace of clubs wins the trick for us. So, the lead is back with me. Now comes the crunch. Is the distribution of trumps on our side? Well, there are only two out against us, but they do happen to be the ace and the king, both with one opponent or one with each. Only one way to find out. Lead another trump.
Five of hearts.
Ace of hearts.
From dummy, the seven of hearts.
King of hearts.
Ace wins. My lead couldn't have been sitting better for them. Now, what to lead? Well, partner led clubs last time. He may have the king. So, back to clubs we go. Eight of clubs.
And from dummy, the ten of clubs.
Jack of clubs.
And king of clubs.
Hard luck, Amanda. You thought your partner might have the king, didn't you? But he didn't. I did. And it leaves the queen in dummy as master. Unbeatable. Now, let's pause and review our strategy. Eight tricks we need. Three we have. Five to go. Opponents' trumps all drawn. I've got three left, and there's still one in dummy. There are still the diamonds to make, all of which are good, as we have four top honours between us, and Queen of Clubs is master. We're going to be all right.
Ace of diamonds.
Four of diamonds.
And from dummy, five of diamonds.
Two of diamonds.
Queen of diamonds.
Nine of diamonds.
From dummy, eight of diamonds.
Six of diamonds.
Now to make dummy's king of diamonds.
Three of diamonds.
With no diamonds left to follow suit, and all my trumps drawn, there's nothing I can do but discard. Three of clubs.
And from dummy, king of diamonds.
Seven of diamonds.
And the last three tricks are ours, whichever way I play them. Master cards in dummy and all trumps in my hand. No point in playing out the agony.
And the last three tricks are ours, I believe. Two hearts bid, three made.
Well done, partner. Two hearts bid, three made. That's 60 points below the line. 30 above for the over trick, so we are now 60 points towards gain. I know what you're thinking. What's he on about now? Just as we got the hang of the point system to judge the strength of our hands, he's muttering about 60 points towards gain. Well, the point system for evaluating your hand has got nothing to do with the points you score for bidding and making a contract. So let's forget value points for the moment and concentrate on scoring points. Yeah. So, in bridge, the first partnership to score 100 points wins the game. And the first to win two games wins the rubber. So, how do you score? Well, providing you make the contract bid, every trick won scores points for you, depending on which suit the contract is in. If the hand is played in no trumps, and you make your contract, you score 40 points for the first trick above the book, that's the first six tricks, and 30 for every subsequent trick won. In major suits, spades and hearts, you score 30 points for every trick. And in minor suits, diamonds and clubs, 20 points a trick. So, three no trumps, four spades or hearts, or five diamonds or clubs are all game calls. And if you win more tricks than you bid, well, they score bonus points, but they don't count towards the game. 30 points for no trumps and majors, 20 points for minors. But of course, all this is supposing that you make the contract that you bid. Supposing you don't, what if in your enthusiasm you overbid and fail to make it? Well, you're penalised. 50 points for every trick short of the contract. 50 points, irrespective of whether it was no trumps, major suit, or minor suit. So, if you bid five diamonds, and you only make three, 100 penalty points are awarded to your opponents. Now you know why we stopped at two hearts instead of going on to a game call of four. We made three, and we would rather have that 60 points down there below the line with a bonus of 30 for the overtrick above it than have 50 penalty points over here in our opponent's column above the line, even though being above the line, it wouldn't count towards game. But what I would have you consider is when you make an opening bid, you are opening negotiations with your eye on a game call. So your choice of suit or no trump or whatever at that early stage of the game is crucial to the final contract. Now, we've already discussed the requirements for opening one of a suit. 13 to 19 points. Most important. But this is even more important. What do you open? Because some hands are simply automatic. They've got good biddable and rebiddable suits. But what about the hands that have two or even three biddable suits? With which one do we open? Well, the first consideration must be to consider the rebid situation. Because if we open the bidding and partner, who hasn't yet passed, makes a positive bid, what in bridge terms we call an unlimited response, we must keep the bidding open. Well, while my partner was winning the last hand, I sorted out some examples. They are all openers, all opening hands, but they do appear to offer a choice of opening bid. We'll try them out on our three guinea pigs and tune in on their thoughts of what they would bid and why. All right, Tessa, my love, you first.
Thanks for nothing. Let's just check that Shaw's not having me on with the point count. 2, 6, 9, 12, 15 for honours, and one distribution point for the diamonds. 16. Plenty to open on. Biddable hearts and rebiddable diamonds. Hearts stronger in honours, but length is more important. One diamond.
Right on. Why?
Length every time. The more I have, the less there can be with the opposition. The longer the suit, the more control you have.
What can I say? Absolutely right. All right, Amanda, your turn.
Two biddable and one rebiddable suit and a void in clubs. Strong honours in diamonds and in hearts, no honours at all. But still, length over strength. And who knows what partner may respond with.
One heart.
Absolutely right again. If you have a rebiddable suit, that's five cards or more, that is the one you open with, irrespective of the strength of the suit. What happens if you have two rebiddable suits? Well, I'll come to that in just a moment. There you are, Peter. Try that for size.
All right, thank you. Three biddable suits and a singleton in diamonds. But which one to open with? And the principle is to open with the suit below the singleton in rank. Thus, clubs. And whatever partner now bids, my response is simple. If she bids one diamond, I rebid one heart. If she says one heart or one spade, I raise her in her suit. If she bids two clubs, a limit bid, I pass. So?
One club.
Ah, shucks, you got it right. And I deliberately put those spades in there just to tempt you.
Yeah, I realise that. With three biddable suits, always open with the one below the singleton.
That's absolutely right. But how about two biddable four-card suits? There you go, Tessa. You enjoy this more than most. You ever go at that one?
Let's see what you're tempting me with here.
Well, the first temptation is to bid one diamond, because that's strongest in honours. But we're used to Shaw's temptations. If I bid diamonds now, what do I bid next time round? Of course, the key to good bidding is, before you open, think of your second round bid. All right, let's see. If I bid the lower-ranking suit diamonds now and bid the higher-ranking suit hearts next time round, I'll be pushing the contract to the three level if my partner wants to put me back to diamonds. So,
sorry to disappoint you, Satan. One heart.
What can I say? Yet another secret of the good opener revealed. When the two biddable suits are next to each other in rank, touching, in other words, for instance, spades and hearts, or hearts and diamonds, as in this case, always bid the higher-ranking suit first, irrespective of the strength. So partner, if he wishes, can put you back into your opening suit at the two level instead of having to go up to three. The situation is different with two biddable four-card suit not touching, not next to each other in rank, in other words. Take a look at these. There you go. Hearts and clubs. Bid the lower suit first. And that gives your partner a chance to get in at the one level with a suit bid that needs only a six-point valuation. There is one other I promised I would mention. What happens when you are faced with two rebiddable suits? In other words, five or more cards in length, and they are both the same length. Well, the answer is bid the highest ranking, irrespective of honour strength, or whether they're next to each other, or in other words, touching. And all that is so important, I think it's worth writing down for you. If both a biddable and a rebiddable suit is held, and you have enough valuation points to open, bid the longest suit. If you have three biddable four-card suits, then the 13th card must be a singleton. Bid the suit that ranks immediately below it. With two biddable suits that are touching or next to each other in rank, bid the higher suit. If they are not touching, bid the lower suit. And if you have two rebiddable suits of the same length, for instance, five cards each, bid the higher suit, whether they are touching or not. Of course, if one is longer than the other, say six and five, then you bid the longer. And now, do you think you've got the opening bidding all sorted out? 13 to 19 points, biddable or rebiddable suits, and most important, a sound rebid? Good. And allow me to toss a minuscule spanner in the works. Here you are, my golden guineas. Every hand an opener. But what?
Very crafty.
Now let's make a point count first. One, five, six, nine, 11, 14. And no distribution points. Yes, it's an opener, all right. But what do I open? Aha! This hand fits into another slot. Balanced hand, 13 to 14 points.
I would open one no trump.
And you would be absolutely right. How about you, partner?
Well, I've certainly got a biddable suit here, but just let me think.
How many points, for starters? 4, 6, 9, 12, 13. And spades, a good biddable suit. But just a moment. Supposing I do open one spade, what can I rebid if my partner responds with, say, 2 diamonds? Neither hearts nor clubs are biddable. My spades aren't rebiddable. I daren't rebid 2 no-trumps. That'll make him think I've got a stronger hand, 15 to 16 points, and then he'd go leaping into a game call. On 13 points, I must open. But let's face it, I don't have a sound rebid.
Same again, Shaw. I'd open 1 no-trump.
And you too would be absolutely right. How about you, my lovely?
Well, obviously, I'm going to finish up opening 1 no-trump. But let's see how I get there.
Not quite as balanced as the other two hands. But how many points? 4, 6, 10, 13, 14. A strong biddable suit in hearts. But where is my sound rebid? I haven't won.
You'd have a fit if I opened 1 heart, wouldn't you? So I won't. 1 no-trump.
Well done, that girl. Well, there you are. 3 different hands, but all with 1 no-trump openings. I wonder if you spotted the similarities. First of all, the point count, 13 and 14. And that's all, no more. Clearly limited in values. Second, the shape of the hands. No singletons, no voids. All 3 are balanced hands. And third, and most important, you don't need a rebid to open no trumps. So, what does the opening of 1 no-trump tell your partner? It tells your honours point count to within narrow limits, 13 or 14. It tells him that you have a balanced hand with no singleton or void, so with any suit he cares to respond, he knows that you will have at least a doubleton to back him. The final contract is virtually his decision. There are several schools of thought about the point count needed for a 1 no-trump opening. Some favour the lower limit of 13 or 14 points. Others go for what is known as the strong no-trump, 16 to 18 points. But providing you all know which you are playing, there are no problems of communication between you. However, always one to like something just a little different, I'd like to recommend the popular Ackle system, which has a little bit of each. You play the weak no-trump opening when you are non-vulnerable, and the strong no-trump when you are vulnerable. I know what you're saying, but what's all this with vulnerability? Where does he get all these words? Right, I'll explain it to you. Vulnerable is what we will be if we win this next hand and reach game. 2 out of 3 games wins the rubber, right? So as soon as you win 1 game, you become vulnerable, which simply means that if you don't make your contract, the penalty points against you are doubled from 50 to 100 for every trick you alight. It does sharpen up your bidding and your play, I can tell you. Now, what do we need to become vulnerable? Well, take a look at the score sheet. We have 60 below the line. That means we are 60 towards game, the first game of the rubber. Only the below-the-line score counts towards game. Above the line here is for bonuses and overtricks. 60 towards game. Game is 100. So all we need is 40 points. Just a simple 1 no-trump or 2 of a suit, bid and made, is all we need. You dealt my treasure, it's you to bid.
Looks like an opener here with 2 biddable suits. Let's take a point count. 3 for the king of spades, plus 4 for the ace of hearts is 7. 4 more for the ace of clubs, 11. And 3 for the king, 14. No distribution points, so 14 it is. A fairly balanced hand of 4 hearts, 4 clubs, 3 diamonds, 2 spades, no singletons, no voids, and the right number of points for a 1 no-trump opening. 1 no-trump.
Oh, lucky old you. I've stared and stared at my hand. I've got 2 biddable suits, spades and clubs. In fact, spades are rebiddable. I still can't find more than 9 points. Oh, it's a nice hand to respond on, but it's certainly not enough to overcall at the 2 level. So, with hope still springing, I'll just have to leave it to my partner.
No bid.
So, my partner opens one no trump, meaning that she's 13 or 14 points and a balanced hand, which makes my hand very interesting indeed. With a point count of 4, 5, 9, 12 on a points, plus a distribution point for the fifth diamond, I've got enough points here to open myself, let alone respond. At least 26 points between us, maybe 27. And just under 3 points a trick, that's 9 tricks in no trumps. Well, with that combined point count, we must go to game. But in what? With 3 spades and 2 hearts, and Amanda opening no trumps, we haven't sufficient cards for a major suit game. The only other fit we may have is in diamonds. But that would mean 5 diamonds. 11 tricks, no. No, I'm taking the obvious course that only needs 9 tricks.
3 no trumps.
Obviously, Shaw's prayers haven't been answered. And on this hand, there's no way I can help him out. 2 queens, 2 jacks.
No bid.
Bless you, partner. No need for me to say more. No bid.
No bid. And 3 no bids in a row mean the end of the bidding. Our opponents are in a contract of 3 no trumps, with Amanda, who introduced no trumps into the bidding first, as the declarer. And you and I have so much to talk about. But first, let me make the opening lead so that Dummy can go down and Amanda can plan her strategy.
Now, which of what suit? In this contract, there aren't any trumps, so we want to try to establish a long suit. And for me, that's obviously spades. The ace and king are missing, but the conventional opening is either 4th highest of the longest suit, or, if you hold a sequence, the highest of that sequence. Well, queen, jack, 10 are a sequence, so...
the queen of spades. Now, Amanda is going to need a little while to plan her strategy on this hand, so let's just recap on what you've learned so far about scoring. Because if you overbid and you fail in your contract, penalty points are awarded against you. 50 points for every trick you go down. In other words, you are short of your contract. And if you already have a game to your credit and you are therefore vulnerable, it's going to cost you 100 points for every one down. All these points go above the line on your opponent's side of the score sheet and, of course, don't count towards game. Now, don't worry too much about memorising all these figures because most brand new packs of cards have, as well as the jokers, a card showing bridge scoring. You can always keep that by your side. And I'll tell you about other bonuses, etc., etc., as we go along. Meanwhile, let us to the task in hand, and that is to earn ourselves a few penalty points by defeating our opponent's contract of 3 no trumps. I hope. Right, Amanda. You seem to have a knotty problem.
You can say that again. 3 no trumps means 9 tricks we have to win. And on the face of it, we only have 7 top tricks. Ace king of spades will make. Ace of hearts. Ace king of diamonds. And ace king of clubs. Somewhere along the line, I've got to develop 2 more tricks. Spades. No. Hearts? Obviously, we only make the ace. And with only 6 hearts and opponents with 7 against us, including king and queen, no again. Might be able to develop 1 more trick in clubs. But 1's not enough. I need 2. Best chance is diamonds. Dummy and I have 8 between us to the ace king. Now, if the 5 against us are divided 3-2, I can take 2 tricks with the ace-king, lose the 3rd, and that will leave 2 more in dummy as winners. Providing I keep an entry into dummy. Right, here we go.
From dummy, the 2 of spades.
5 of spades.
King of spades. King of spades wins our trick. My lead.
And I'd better start to establish our diamonds straight away.
The 3 of diamonds.
Nine of diamonds.
From dummy, ace of diamonds.
Seven of diamonds.
Ace of diamonds wins. The lead is in dummy. King of diamonds.
Jack of diamonds.
Four of diamonds. And now the crunch. Does Shaw have another diamond, or will he discard? If he does, I'm faced with a 4-1 split and disaster.
Unfortunately, I have to follow suit. 10 of diamonds.
King of diamonds wins. Our trick. The lead is in dummy.
Thank heavens for that. Only one diamond missing. Clear that, and I can make the two that will be left in dummy.
From dummy, the two of diamonds.
Queen of diamonds.
Five of diamonds.
And I discard the four of clubs.
Queen wins. Our trick.
Now, I've got a problem. Partner led spades from strength, but we've got to knock out the ace control in dummy before they can be effective. At the same time, it means that our opponents can make the two small diamonds. Well, I can't stop her while the ace is there, so...
Nine of spades.
Four of spades.
And six of spades.
From dummy, the ace of spades. Ace of spades wins. Our trick. And I'm in dummy for the last time. Because with the ace gone, I've no further entry. So I'll have to take my two established diamonds while I can.
From dummy, the eight of diamonds. I'll discard the three of hearts.
And I haven't any diamonds either, so I shall discard the two of hearts.
I will discard the seven of spades.
Eight of diamonds wins. From dummy, the six of diamonds.
And I'll discard the six of hearts.
And I'll discard the five of hearts.
Likewise, eight of hearts.
Six of diamonds wins. Now, am I going to be greedy and try to make an overtrick in clubs? Not with the four of spades still out. One wrong move and I could ditch my contract. How many tricks have I got? One, two, three, four, five, six. And I'm going to lead from dummy to my ace, king of clubs, and I'm going to take my ace of hearts as well for nine tricks. And you're welcome to the rest.
Well done, Amanda. Three no trumps, bid and made. Now, let's see, that's 100 points below the line for you. And our part score no longer counts towards game, although it will be added into the final reckoning. And, of course, your being one game towards rubber makes you vulnerable. So if you go down on your contract, any under-tricks are going to cost you a penalty of 100 points, not just 50, all right? But then you don't intend going down on the next contract, do you? By the same token, I hope my partner and I are going to get the cards to at least win a game, even things up, and stop you getting a two-game rubber. Meanwhile, are you at all bemused at what's happened? Well, I hope not, because I deliberately didn't stop to make explanations throughout, because I wanted you to experience the whole thing right the way through, the bidding, the play, and the scoring, just to show you the endless fascination of bridge and how the tables can be turned in just one hand. We've already discussed at length what you need to open the bidding, a biddable suit, preferably a rebiddable suit, but certainly a sound rebid, plus a point count of between 13 and 19 to open at the one level. But what we haven't discussed is, when your partner opens, how many points do you need to respond? Well, the simple answer is not so many. You already know that your partner has at least 13 points. And on our rough and ready guide of 3 points to a trick, 4 and a bit tricks. Now, the least you need to be able to offer to respond is 2 more tricks, 6 points in other words. That, plus the advantage of choosing trumps, should see you home at the one level. But if you need to raise the level to the 2, because the suit ranking, You're obviously going to need one more trick. Three more points, in other words. Say, for instance, partner opens one heart. You want to respond diamonds or clubs. Well, to do that, you've got to go to the two level, haven't you? And therefore, you would need a minimum of 9 points. Obviously, you've already valued your hand, 4, 3, 2, 1 for honours, plus one distribution point for every card over 4 in a suit. You don't have enough points to open. Partner does. So what are you looking for now? You're looking for a fit. How your hand will dovetail into your partner's so that the choice of suit or no trump will be the right one for the hand to be played in. Often, of course, you'll find it right away. With a point count of 17 and 2 biddable suits, partner has opened one heart. The highest ranking of the 2 biddable suits, because they are touching next to each other. You look at your hand, and there's a fit staring you in the face. You know your partner must have at least 4 hearts to an honour, possibly 5. And you have 4 hearts to support him. So there's the fit. Obviously, a heart contract is favourite. But hold on there. Your partner will be delighted to see your Doubleton diamond. Because as soon as that is exhausted, he can trump in all others. If it had been a singleton, he'd have been even more delighted and positively ecstatic with the void. Well, that's got to be worth extra distribution points, hasn't it, when you're valuing your hand? And, of course, it is. As a responder, you can add 1 point for a Doubleton, 2 for a singleton, and 3 for a void, providing you have good trump support in your partner's suit. There's no sense in adding them in if you haven't got the trump to trump in with, is there? Right. With that little bit of extra knowledge, let's turn our other players into responders and do a little brain picking. I've sorted out a hand for each one of you, and on the premise that I have opened one heart, I want each of you in turn to be my partner and tell me what you would respond. Peter, I've opened one heart. What would you respond on that hand?
Now, you open one heart, right?
That's right.
Well, I'll just value the hand first. 2, 6, 7, 8 total points. 2 biddable suits with diamonds the longer of the two. But that would mean raising the level to 2 to respond in diamonds. And with less than 9 points, that's not on. But I can keep it at the one level by responding with spades. And as a simple change of suit is forcing for one round, my partner must rebid. And if need be, I may be able to show my diamonds later.
One spade.
One spade it is. Absolutely right. When you've only got 6 to 8 points and a fairly balanced hand, make the cheapest bid. Keep it at the one level. Now then, there you go, Tessa. Your turn. What would you respond to my opening of one heart?
Oh, yes, I see what Shaw's up to. He's given me an even stronger rebiddable diamond suit to tempt me into the two level. But does the point count warrant it? 3, 6, 7 honours points, 1 distribution point for the extra diamond. But I can't add 1 for the Doubleton Club because I haven't got 4 card support in hearts. No, it still only comes to 8 points. Not enough for two level. So I'll settle for the same as Peter. Show my spades.
1 spade.
Clever girl. Right again, you see. You just weren't strong enough to go to the two level, even though the diamonds were longer than the spades. Opener always calls the longest suit first. Responder doesn't have to. And to show a major suit is more constructive. But if you have 11 points or more, you can show both the suits, the longer minor first, and then the major. And now, Amanda, what will you show us?
Well, having listened to the professor rabbiting on all this time, seeing all those tricky fixed hands spread about, I was completely convinced I was going to be another one spader. Looking at this hand, I'm not so sure.
I have 7 points, enough to respond. But I don't have a biddable suit. I could respond with 1 no trump. It's a limit bid. It shows my point holding within strict limits, between 6 and 8. and it reflects a balanced hand.
Surprise, surprise. One, no trump.
Absolutely right. And of course, being a limit bid, it's not forcing, so I don't have to rebid. So I can either leave us in one no trump and you'd have to play the hand, or I can go back to hearts, to two hearts, or two of any other suit, or I could even support your no trumps if I was strong enough. So there you have it. Minimum responses to a one opening. Now, Amanda here responded one no trump because she hadn't got a biddable suit, but she did have between 6 and 8 points. The other two showed their major suit, spades, because they couldn't venture in at the two level. They just hadn't the necessary values, 9 points. But there is a situation where you can raise to the two level on minimum values. Take a look at this hand. It's just such a hand as we were talking about a short while ago, where you've got support for your partner's suit, in this case, hearts, and not much else. If you value this hand, you'll see that you have 6 honour points, plus 1 distribution point for the shortage of spades. Remember, 1 for a doubleton, 2 for a single, and 3 for a void. You could respond 1 no trump to your partner's opening of 1 heart, but that wouldn't show the fit in hearts here. So, you make a single raise to 2 hearts. You are virtually saying, I've got support for your suit partner, but simply minimum values, limited to between 6 and 9 points. So, if your partner opens in a major suit, and you hold 4 of them, raise your partner in his own suit. And the level you raise him to indicates the number of points you hold within strict limits. It's a limit bid. Therefore, it's not forcing on partner to rebid. The decision on whether to go on is left to him. And when you realise that a joint holding of 26 points should be enough for you to make 10 tricks in a suit call, you'll see the sense of those limit responses. If partner opened on a minimum of 13 points and you hold 13 to 15, you must be in game. If he or she opened on a maximum of 19 points with a one opening, you're in the slam zone. But all this is very heady stuff, isn't it? Here we are discussing responses to an opening at the one level, and already we're contemplating slams. So let me come down to earth with the thought that partner may open not in a major, but in a minor suit. Now, even though you may hold 4 or more of that suit, it isn't constructive to raise it if you hold a biddable major. Because bear in mind, fewer game contracts are played in the minor suits, so it's worth exploring the position in the majors. Who knows? You might discover a fit in a major, or it might enable you to play in no trumps. And it's a lot easier to make a game at the 3 or 4 level than it is at the 5 level. However, how about this game? Now, you know the score, and I reckon you know enough about bridge now to mentally take my seat here and bid this hand. I dealt, so I'm first to bid. Now, take a look at that. What should I bid? I'll give you a little while to think about it. What do you think? Yeah, it's pretty obvious, isn't it? 14 points, including 1 for the 5th spade. Remember, at least a biddable suit, and preferably a rebiddable one and a sound rebid. Well, spades are all of that, aren't they? 1 spade.
Well, Shaw started the ball rolling, and being 1 game up, we're vulnerable. So I've got to be even more careful how I bid. What have I got? Not a lot. 6 honest points. Just enough had partner opened the bidding to respond at the 1 level. But Shaw's put pay to that with an opening of 1 spade. All I can do is sit back for the moment and see if Amanda has anything to say.
No bid. Now, you're in a good position. You know that I've opened 1 spade. You know that Peter has passed. So now nip round, have a look at Tessa's hand and see what you would respond to a 1 spade opening. We'll give you a few seconds before we tune into Tessa's thoughts.
Well, if Shaw's looking for a fit, he needn't look any further. I've nearly had one myself. One spade he opens, and I'm sitting here with five of them to three honours. Now, let's not get too excited. Let's have a point count. 12 honours, plus one distribution point for the fifth spade. And as I've got trump support, I can now revalue my hand and count two more for the singleton diamond. 15 points altogether. Do I show my hearts? No. Even if partner opened on a minimum 13 points, we've found a major fit and have game values between us, so let's not beat about the bush.
Four spades.
Oh, straight to game call. Well, well, well. The auction has reached a high level already. What can we do about that? Nothing much on this hand. 9 points in honours. Three distributional points for the fifth, sixth and seventh diamond. I must be able to do something with seven diamonds. But can I? Means joining in the bidding at the five level. 11 tricks, and we're vulnerable. It could cost the earth if we went down, especially if we were doubled. Our partner has already passed. Would it be sensible for us to double them? No, I don't think so. To beat them, we'd need four tricks. I may make the ace king of clubs, but I need two more tricks from partner to defeat the contract.
No bid.
My dear partner has gone straight to game, with a limit bid showing at least four card support for my spades and 13 to 15 points. So a joint valuation with my hand gives us between 28 and 30 points, because I can now add another point for my doubleton diamond. Her spades have been agreed. Plenty for game, but not enough to start looking for a slam. And as a limit bid is not forcing, I don't have to do a thing, except play the hand.
No bid.
No bid.
And three no bids in a row ends the auction. We have contracted to make four spades, that's 10 tricks. I'm the declarer. Peter, you to lead.
Now, they've got to take 10 tricks. So if we can find four, we can beat them. Doesn't seem very likely. My king of diamonds might be useful, but I've only two trumps and no singletons or voids. I only hope Amanda can do something about this, because I certainly can't. So, what shall I lead? I have a sequence of three touching clubs headed by the jack, so clubs it is. Lead the highest of a sequence.
Jack of clubs.
Well, I don't think you're going to be very disappointed with this hand, Shaw. There you go.
Nothing wrong with that. Oh, it's all right for you. You've already seen my partner's hand. Now, I tell you what, come round here. Let's look at both hands together and plan our strategy.
Well, no problem with trumps, are there? 10 between us, only three low ones out against us. So at worst, three rounds will draw them out. Ace, king, queen of hearts are good. Diamonds are no problem. I have the ace, and the singleton in dummy means I can trump any others from there. But clubs are a problem, and we're facing a club lead. So it doesn't look as though the queen will be much use, does it? I'm going to lose three clubs, I think. But no spades, hearts or diamonds. So we should make our contract. Only a freak distribution of those missing six hearts, in other words, if they're all in one hand, before I can draw trumps could spell disaster for us. That's very unlikely.
From dummy. Two of clubs.
Partner led the jack, so he most likely has touching honours in clubs. So he must have the 10. I have the ace king. Queen is in dummy, and Shaw hasn't played it. So my partner's jack is good.
Six of clubs.
Five of clubs.
Jack of clubs wins. Our trick. Ten of clubs.
From dummy. Four of clubs.
King of clubs.
Seven of clubs.
King of clubs wins. Your lead, partner.
Ace of clubs.
Eight of clubs.
Three of clubs.
And from dummy, the queen of clubs.
Ace wins. Still your lead, partner.
Three tricks we have. One more, and we've defeated their contract. But where do we find it? A lot may depend on my next lead. I have all those diamonds, and there's a singleton in dummy. Sure open spades. And with a queen, jack, ten in dummy, he probably has the ace and king. So no joy there. Nor in hearts with ace, king and dummy. So our one chance is in diamonds. If my partner has the ace and can make it while that singleton is still in dummy.
Five of diamonds.
Ace of diamonds.
Eight of diamonds.
From dummy. The four of diamonds. Ace of diamonds wins. Our first trick. Now, for a little dentistry, in other words, to draw your trumps. Ace of spades.
Seven of spades.
From dummy. Four of spades.
Nine of spades.
And very nice, too. One trump from each. One to go. Who's got it?
King of spades.
Eight of spades.
From dummy. Six of spades.
I discard the two of diamonds.
Thank you very much, Peter. That's the last of the trumps out against me. Let's see if the heart suit breaks as evenly.
Queen of hearts.
Two of hearts.
From dummy. Three of hearts.
Nine of hearts.
Now, over into dummy and cash the ace and king.
Six of hearts.
Four of hearts.
From dummy, the ace of hearts.
Ten of hearts.
Ace of hearts wins, followed by the king of hearts.
I discard the three of diamonds.
Seven of hearts.
Five of hearts.
So the hearts haven't broken evenly. There are still two to come. There's the eight in dummy, and Peter still has the jack, and I can't afford to lose even one trick. But never fear, I've exhausted my heart holding, and the smallest of trumps will do the trick. So, take it then.
From dummy, the eight of hearts.
Six of diamonds.
I trump with the two of spades.
And there goes my master jack of hearts.
And with trumps left in dummy, the rest of mine. Four spades, bid and made gives us game. There's 120 points. Below the line, one game each. Now we are both vulnerable. If you are convinced that you are strong enough to defeat your opponent's contract, you can say double. And you have doubled the bet. Nay, more than doubled if you defeat them by more than one trick. Just one trick down, and the bet is effectively doubled, 100 penalty points instead of 50, and for each subsequent trick, 200. But if they are vulnerable, it goes up to 200 and 300 respectively. So make sure that you never go down six doubled, vulnerable, because that's 1,700 points. And I've never known a declarer who did and lived. And it could happen just by stupid bidding. But it does give some thought, doesn't it, of how much more careful you have to be in your bidding when you're vulnerable, which we both are at the moment. Being penalty points, of course, they go above the line on the score sheet. They don't count towards game. But what happens if you boldly double your opponents and they make their contract in spite of you? That's a different story. Because then you double their score below the line, and it does count towards game. So you see, you could double a simple two-spade contract into game, 120 points below the line. You also give them 50 penalty points above the line just for being cheeky. And any over-tricks that they make score 100 each, non-vulnerable, and 200 vulnerable. So you'll have begun to realise that doubling is a very serious business. It's not to be undertaken lightly. And I don't know if you are ready for this. When you are convinced that you can defeat your opponent's contract and have said double, they, equally convinced that they can make it, can say redouble. And that doubles the double. In fact, the only thing that remains unchanged is the 50 points for being cheeky, if they make it. That 50, by the way, is called 50 for the insult in bridge terms. It's real nose-to-nose confrontation stuff, this, and it's great fun. It sharpens the concentration on the play no end. One more word before we move on to another aspect of the bidding. It would have occurred to you that doubling and redoubling can be used equally effectively for bidding as well as for betting. In other words, it gives you yet another means of communicating information to your partner. But we'll talk more on that later on. First, one no trump is a limit bid. So partner is telling you his strength within very definite limits. Now, I've sorted out two possible hands here. Both possible one-no-trump opening hands. There they are. Now, study those two carefully. They're both very similar, in as much as they are balanced. They're both of the 4-3-3 shape. Both have a biddable suit. But not one that is rebiddable, and there's no sound rebid. The difference is in their strength. Now, one hand, if you add up the points, this top one here, is worth 16 points, while the one below it is worth 14 points. Some players prefer the weak no-trump opening, others go for the strong no-trump opening. But we are playing one that takes the best of both worlds, in my opinion. It comes under the Ackle system, which is no more frightening than the fact that it was developed in a small bridge club in Ackle Road, West Hampstead, London. And it's simply that you play the weak no-trump opening when you're non-vulnerable, and the strong no-trump opening when you are vulnerable. When you are vulnerable, the penalties are much heavier, so you need to be that much more careful. However, imagine that we are not vulnerable. I've opened with a weak node trump. What do you take into consideration when you respond? Well, there you are, my golden guinea pigs. A carefully doctored hand for each of you. Be my partner. What will you respond to my one-no-trump non-vulnerable opening? I tell you what, I'll give you a break this time, Peter. I'll let Amanda start.
Oh, I'm ready to forego the privilege. Well, the first thing I'm going to take into consideration is how many points we hold jointly between us. Shaw's opening of one-no-trump defines the limit of his holding very clearly to 13 or 14 points. So even if Shaw is maximum, we have only 22 points between us. Just about sufficient to make out our contract. So,
no bid.
Fair enough. The point count obviously wasn't enough to advance the bidding, so we are left in one no trump, and if our opponents don't enter the bidding, that is what we will play, and I will play the hand. Seven tricks to make, I might just do it, but it won't be a complete disaster if I go down. Now, Tessa, my genuine partner, what is your response to my one-no-trump non-vulnerable opening?
Well, Amanda passed on her hand, but I don't think I will on mine. Nine honours plus one distribution point for the fifth heart. Not enough combined points to consider game. But I think we'd be better in a trump contract than no trumps. Because I have a Doubleton spade and a Doubleton club. Good five-card heart suit. So I could trump in hearts when they're both exhausted. And if partner opened one no trump, he must have got a balanced hand. And so he must have hearts.
Two hearts.
And from that, partner, I deduce that you have not a very strong hand. It's a weak takeout bid, in fact. That it's not a balanced hand, and that you have length in hearts, at least five, right? Well, I must pass on a weak takeout bid, because two of a suit response to a one-no-trump opening is not forcing. In fact, it's a stop bid. Partner, knowing my hand to within a point, has made the decision I must not go on. But on the other hand, if she had made a jump bid of three hearts, I would have had to go on because a jump bid of three is forcing. In fact, it's forcing to game. Now, what are you hiding there, Peter?
I think we might have a jump bid. Well, there's no doubt that we have enough points for game between us. 14 points in my hand and 13 or 14 in shorts. The question is, do we stand a better chance in four spades or three no trumps? Shaw may have a doubleton, and that doubleton could be spades. Well, he's the only person who knows, so let him decide. In that case, I shall bid
three spades.
And that jump bid of three spades over my opening of one no trump tells me all I need to know, that our joint holding is enough to go for game. But my partner has very wisely left the final decision to me. He knows I have to bid because that jump bid is forcing, and if I only hold two of the suit that he bid, in other words, spades, I shall bid three no trumps, game call. On the other hand, if I hold three or more of his suit, I'll bid four spades, which is also game call, because I know that we will have eight or more trumps between us. As I said earlier, it's common sense, really. Your response to an opening of one no trump is based firstly on whether the number of points held between you could make game, bearing in mind that the opener is promising 13 or 14 points, and secondly, is the shape of your hand better suited to playing in no trumps or in a suit? For instance, take a look at these two hands and tell me what you would respond to a weak one no trump opening. Now, this one first. Take your time, there's no rush. What do you make of it? Balanced hand, 12 points. So you have at least 25 points between you, possibly 26 if partners at a maximum. Well, there's only one person who knows, and that's partner himself, so you just leave it to him. You bid two no trumps. He now knows that you have 12 points. If he opened on minimum, he will pass, because he knows that you have 25 points between you, enough for eight tricks, not nine. Now, supposing you are holding this hand. Now, imagine I've opened a weak one no trump. What are you going to say to me? I'm not prompting you. You work it out for yourself. Sorry, partner, what did you say? Three no trumps? Great. You have a balanced hand of the 4-3-3-3 variety, which is best suited for no trump play. You've got enough points to open yourself. Why muck about? Go straight to game. Three no trumps. The really top men and women in the game, the internationals, like our programme advisor, Jack Nunes, eat, drink and sleep bridge and are forever considering ways in the bidding to improve communication between partners, but still within the limits of bridge language, without inflection or without mannerisms. Every so often, an idea is such a good one, it becomes adopted into the game as a recognised convention, not solely for the experts, but for ordinary mortals like ourselves who just enjoy a game of bridge. It is, of course, known that some hands would play better in a major suit than in no trumps, providing there was a 4-4 fit. Imagine that my partner has opened one no trump, and I am holding that hand. Do you know what I'm going to respond? I am going to respond two clubs. No, I haven't taken leave of my senses. I'm introducing stamen. As soon as partner hears my two-club bid, he knows that I'm asking him if he has a four-card major suit. He knows that I have, and that I'm looking for a fit. So, if he has, he bids it. Two hearts or two spades. If he hasn't either, then he bids two diamonds. And that's it. So, with this hand, if we've found a major fit, I put him into game in that suit by bidding four of them. If there's no major fit, I put him back into no trumps at the three level. So that is the basis of the stamen convention. One no trump, two clubs. I'm interested to know if you have a four-card major suit, and if you have, bid it. If not, bid two diamonds. Yeah, go on. I know what you're thinking. Supposing you've got four of each. Well, you bid the hearts first. Let's just have a couple of for instances. Opener with a 13-point balanced hand opens one no trump. Responder with 12 points and a singleton club can see game possibilities, but he's rather concerned about that singleton club. Can he find a fit in hearts or spades? So he initiates stamen. He bids two clubs. Opener replies, two spades, thereby showing less than four hearts, because he'd have bid those first if he'd had them. Anyway, responder is delighted with the spade fit, eight between them, so the responder doesn't hesitate. He had 12 points to start with, but now he knows that the opener has four spades. His hand improves to 14 points because of that singleton club. So, straight to game, four spades. Now, study those hands very carefully, because without stamen, they could easily have found themselves in three no trumps. And what a pasting they would have taken in clubs. So you see why Sam Stamen's convention came and stayed. What a lot of information relayed in a couple of simple bids. Let's look at one more example, not quite so clear-cut. Opener, with a balanced 13-point hand, opens one no-trump. Responder has 11 points and would like to find a fit in spades. So he initiates stamen, two clubs. Opener, holding two four-card major suits, bids the hearts first, two hearts. Oh, dear, oh, dear. That's not at all what the responder was hoping to hear. So what does he do now? Well, normal bidding. Have to put the opener back into no trumps. Hasn't got sufficient points for game. So, two no trumps. Now, opener thinks responder must have a four-card major, or he wouldn't have initiated stamen in the first place. So if responder hasn't supported hearts, he must have four spades. So over two no trumps, the opener bids three spades. Now, what a difference that has made to the responder's hand. Now he knows the opener holds four cards in spades. That singleton is worth two more valuation points. So he hasn't got 11, he's got 13 points, enough for game. So, four spades. One last word on stamen, which must have crossed your mind. Supposing all you want to do is show a weak takeout in clubs. You've got a yard of them and not much else. But you can't expect to bid two clubs and then play it there because you're initiating stamen. The only thing is that when partner bids a major or two diamonds, you can rebid clubs at the three level. And he will then get the message and will pass. But it does mean you've got to be prepared to play in clubs at the three level. So you must therefore have at least six of them and a hand better suited to playing in clubs than no trumps. Game all. Both sides are vulnerable. Peter, you dealt, so it's you to bid.
And bid I shall. Well, this looks like the sort of hand that could win the rubber for us, if partner has something. 15 honours points plus one distribution point for the fifth spade. Diamonds biddable. Spades rebiddable. All the requirements are there. Open from length.
One spade.
Oh, now that's rotten luck. I've got an opener here, and Peter's whipped him before me. Oh, well, let me take another count. 13 honest points and two more for distribution. Rebiddable hearts and clubs. And if partner can offer support, I could revalue my hand by another 3 points for the void in spades. Oh, an ideal hand for an informative double. But Shaw hasn't covered that yet, so let's keep it simple. Two hearts.
So, both partnerships are in bidding. Well, I'm not going to be left out. Partner has opened with one spade. What can I bid in response? Well, four card support in spades for a start, so I can add one more distribution point for the Doubleton hearts. That plus the three honours in clubs gives me 7 points. Best to show my spade support with minimum raise. Two spades.
auction's going a bit high for what I hold here. 3, 6 on a points, and another 3 for distribution. And remarkably good support for my partner's suit. I got 5 of them. Tessa must have a reasonable hand to compete at the 2 level when we're vulnerable. I must let her know I have something for her. Trouble is, I've got to go up to the 3 level. Oh, well.
3 hearts.
Partner has supported my suit with a bid of 2 spades. So I can revalue and add 2 more points for the singleton heart. 18 points. If Parna has responded on 6 or 7, we're still slightly short of the 26 points that we need for game call. Our opponents are bidding strongly as well. So, on balance, a little caution may not be misplaced.
3 spades.
Well, Shaw has supported me in hearts. So I can revalue and add 3 points for my spade void. To come in at 3 level, Shaw should have about 9 points. So between us, we have 27 points. Oh, should be game here. So, over our opponent's 3 spades, I'll bid 4 hearts.
Oh dear, this is all going a bit over the top for my little hand. I only intended making 1 bid on this, just a minimum raise of 2 spades, because I only had 7 points. So, that's my lot.
No bid.
No bid?
Opponents bidding strongly and now in game. The 3 spades we should make. But Amanda hasn't taken us to 4, so she must have a minimum. On the other hand, I do have some defence against 4 hearts. But with Amanda supporting my suit, spades, the chances are that one of our opponents is going to be short of them. Might even have a void and be able to trump my ace-king. Well, I don't see why we should let the rubber go without a fight. I might not be able to make the 4 spades, but I do stand a chance. A lot depends on their distribution. We've got 9 between us, 4 out against us. But they're not all likely to be in one hand. It's against average expectancy. Well, we can't give that much away.
4 spades.
Not much I can say to that. Shaw gave me heart support, and I can see 4 hearts here. But not 5. Maybe Shaw has something. No bid.
No bid.
Now, let's just think on this. My partner came in at the 2 level and eventually went on to game, so she must have something. I've got 2 sure tricks in trumps, with Queen Jack 10 and 9. Possibly the King of Diamonds, if the ace is well placed. I reckon we could defeat this contract. So, if we're going to be robbed of the rubber in this hand, let's score as much as we can.
Double.
No bid.
No bid. No bid.
4 spades it is. Doubled. You to lead, partner.
Remember the rules. With a sequence of touching honours, lead the highest. Ace of hearts.
Such excitement. Game all, both vulnerable, and our opponents are playing a contract of 4 spades doubled. And Peter is declarer.
I've got a feeling we're in with a chance. 9 trumps between us, 4 out against. If they're divided 2 and 2, they'll be drawn by the ace-king, and all spades are good. I must lose 1 heart before I can trump in. And what about diamonds? If the king sits with Shaw, I can finesse with the queen and jack. And the moment the king shows his head, take it with my ace. Clubs. Lose 1 to the missing ace. So, if distribution is with us, I shall make the contract with 1 overtrick. If not, well, we'll worry about that when it happens. So, first I test the trump suit. drive out the ace of clubs with one honour, and use the other two for entry into dummy, and start to establish my diamonds. Well, all very nice, if it works.
Ace of hearts led. From dummy, the seven of hearts.
Four of hearts.
Jack of hearts.
Ace wins. My lead. King of hearts.
From dummy, the eight of hearts.
Five of hearts.
And I trump with the four of spades.
Right. Trump testing time.
Ace of spades.
I'll discard the two of hearts.
From dummy, the two of spades.
Nine of spades.
Ace wins. My lead.
What bad luck. The worst possible break in trumps. The queen jack 10-9 out against me and all in Shaw's hand. Oh, no wonder he doubled. What now? One thing's for certain. I mustn't continue with trumps for the moment. If I do, the moment Shaw gets the lead, he'll take out all the trumps and play on good hearts.
Six of clubs.
Ace of clubs.
From dummy, the jack of clubs.
Five of clubs.
Ace of clubs wins. My lead. Two of clubs.
From dummy, the queen of clubs.
Eight of clubs.
Seven of clubs. Queen wins. Lead with dummy.
Well, I still daren't return to trumps, and I must keep the king of clubs for re-entry into dummy. So let's try a little diamond finesse.
From dummy, the ten of diamonds.
Six of diamonds.
Two of diamonds.
And a four of diamonds.
Ten wins. Lead with dummy.
Well, thank heaven something's going my way. The king appears to be with Shaw, and I have Queen Jack in my own hand to finesse again.
From dummy, three of diamonds.
King of diamonds.
Ace of diamonds.
Seven of diamonds.
Ace wins. My lead.
Three remaining trumps out against me. I'll draw one, and then force Shaw to trump in on diamonds.
King of spades.
I'll discard the eight of diamonds.
From dummy, the three of spades.
Ten of spades.
King wins. My lead. Queen of diamonds.
I'll discard the three of clubs.
From dummy, the five of diamonds.
And I trump with the jack of spades.
Jack wins. You to lead, partner.
Queen of spades.
Five of spades.
Discard the four of clubs.
From dummy, the seven of spades. And I can lose no more tricks, as all trumps are out. My jack of diamonds is master, so is the king of clubs in dummy. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. One down, doubled, vulnerable, 200 points.
Well, that's about the best we could do in the circumstances, partner, but not an entirely unsatisfactory result for us.
Yeah, I'll go along with that, and what did he say it would cost them?
Ah, well, now. Normally, it will be 50 points for one down, but as they are vulnerable, it is 100 points. And as I doubled them, 200 points to us.
Well, we didn't do too badly out of it either, because I suspect if we hadn't outbid you and left you in four hearts, you'd have made it and won the rubber.
When we were discussing doubling and redoubling, I suggested you could double not only for penalties, but also as an informative bid, to indicate to your partner the strength and shape of your hand. And what a useful bid it is, because it tells a great deal without having to raise the level of the bidding. It's called a takeout double, or informative double, as distinct from a penalty double. And I'll show you how it works with this hand that I've made up. Now, this is an ideal hand for an informative double. Supposing you've been dealt this, and the opponent on your right opens the bidding with one heart. Now, what immediately strikes you? Right. You are particularly weak in hearts. But at the same time, you have enough values to open the bidding yourself. In fact, if you count up, look, in honours points there, you've got 14 points, in fact. And you've got good support in the other three suits. So really what you would like to know from your partner is which of these three suits does he prefer? Now that's a lot of information to get across in one bid. I'm weak in the suit that our opponents open with, but do have an opening hand myself with good support in the other three suits. Which one do you prefer? Well, all that information can be put across in just one word. Double. Opponent opens one heart, you say double. And your partner gets the full picture immediately. In this particular instance, you've imparted something else. Emphasis is on the major suits. And if the opponent opens in a major, to make an informative double, you should have at least four of the other major suit. And how useful that could be in this hand if your partner has strength in spades. But supposing partner's cupboard is bare, there's not a point to be found anywhere. The bidding runs something like this. Amanda opens one heart. Now, on this hand, I would make an informative double. Peter says no bid. Now, if Tessa says no bid, we could be in trouble. Because Amanda might well decide that a contract of one heart doubled could be a very attractive proposition, especially as she will probably make several overtricks. So, how do you respond if your partner makes an informative double? Well, if the second opponent, that's the one on your right, responds other than pass to his partner's opening bid, well, you're off the hook then, because any advance in the auction automatically cancels out the double. But if opponent number two passes, you must bid, you must respond. However terrible your hand is, you simply bid your best suit at the lowest level you are able to. Supposing Tessa, responding to my informative double, held this hand. She could respond one spade to my informative double of one heart. I know that I've forced her into responding, and I know that she promises nothing. In fact, if I left her in one spade, when I lay down the dummy, you'll find it's not such a bad contract, with hearts to trump after the first round has gone. But don't let's look on the black side. As responder, you may have picked up a rather better hand, something like this one. Now, much more promising. 9 points there, and a doubleton in clubs as well. With a hand of 8 to 10 points, you want to wake your partner up to the fact that you've got a fair hand. And bearing in mind that your partner's double of one heart promised at least 4-card support in the other major suit, spades, you've got no hesitation. You make a jump bid. 2 spades. It's an encouraging bid, but it's not a forcing bid, and once again, partner can make the decision whether or not to proceed from there. If he doubled on the minimum of 13 points, he'd probably leave the contract in 2 spades. But supposing as responder, you hold 12 points or more. Now, you know that your partner has at least 13 points, so you want to go for game. And on a hand like this, you have no doubts what game call it should be. So don't hesitate. Get in there. 4 spades. Now, let me shade it a little more. In this case, spades is obviously the suit, so you've got no doubts about bidding game. But supposing you have a hand that demands a game call, but the suit isn't quite so obvious. You still want to go to game, but you're not entirely sure that spades will provide the best contract. And yet you do want to assure your partner there are game-going values. You need a forcing bid of some kind. And the answer lies, believe it or not, in bidding your opponent's suit. In this case, it would be two hearts. It's called a cue bid. You've got no intention of playing in that suit, but you are insisting that bidding continues until you reach game. Now, I've indulged in a long lecture about informative doubles, so I think a little recap with words wouldn't come amiss, and it will just help the idea to sink in. An immediate double of your opponent's opening bid tells your partner that you have at least 13 points, that you are weak in the opponent's suit, but that you have good support in the other three. Unless opponent number two makes a bid that cancels out the double, it is forcing and it demands a response from your partner. Even with no points at all, partner must bid the best suit. With 8 to 11 points, partner jump bids in his best suit. With 12 or more, partner bids game in best suit. If in doubt as to which is the best suit, then you cue bid by bidding your opponent's suit. Then bidding must continue until game is reached. If you hold guards, in other words, a couple of honours, in the opponent's suit, use the same values to bid 1, 2, or 3 no trumps. Well, having said all that, I hardly know how to tell you this. I'm quite ashamed, really, because it directly contradicts what I first said, but I think you'll understand when I've explained it. You know, I said that if, after an informative double, and opponent number two passes, that you must respond, even if you've got no points at all. Well, there is just one type of hand where you can pass without giving your partner apoplexy. And that is when you are very strong and long in your opponent's suit with good trick-taking potential. Because then you are literally converting that informative double into a penalty double. Because with your partner's known minimum of 13 points and your length and strength in their suit, you are going to take your opponents to the cleaners, to use an old bridge term. In fact, you wouldn't even be averse to your partner leading a small trump, if only a singleton, just to get the massacre underway. One heart, doubled, perhaps even vulnerable as well. Not that I'm a vindictive man, and the word vulnerable does remind me that that is precisely what we are in our present state of play, and as usual, I'm holding up the proceedings by talking too much. Now, where were we? Let's have a look. We were one game each, weren't we? Yes, and on the last hand, we earned ourselves 200 healthy penalty points by defeating their contract of 4 spades by 1 trick. However, Tessa, you dealt, you shall bid.
And bid I shall. There's a fine diamond suit here. 5 to the ace and 4 of them honours. And that's worth 100 bonus points if we gain the contract and play it in diamonds. Now let me value my hand. 13 points, including a distribution point for the 5th diamond. And that's all I need to open. 1 diamond.
So, the bidding has opened. Can I overcall? I've obviously got to do something with a hand like this. 15 points all told, but to no biddable suit. Oh, yes. I know that if I was opening the bidding, both my spades and hearts are biddable. But I'm not opening the bidding. Tessa's already done that. And to overcall her bid, I need at least 5 of a suit. But at the same time, I obviously can't pass on this hand. So what to do? Put Shaw's preaching into practice. I'm weak in diamonds, which is Tessa's suit. But I've got good support in the other 3 suits. So let's see which one Peter prefers with an informative double.
Double.
Surprise, surprise.
So, an informative double by Amanda of my partner's opening bid of 1 diamond. What can I offer? Not a lot.
No bid.
And a no bid from Shaw means that I have to respond to my partner's informative double, which, looking at this hand, I'm not averse to doing. 9 honest points. Spades is obviously my best suit, but if I bid 1 spade, it isn't going to give Amanda a true picture of my hand. That would indicate anything between no points and 7. With nine, I must jump bid.
Two spades.
And with a jump bid to take out double, bang goes my dream of five diamonds and 100 honours.
No bid.
Well now, a jump bid showing a spade suit between 8 and 10 points. Let me revalue my hand. 15 points I had, but I can now add one more for the doubleton in diamonds, as we found a fit in spades. If Peter is maximum, then we have game values. If not, we can't be far off and stand a good chance.
Four spades.
No bid. No bid.
No bid.
Four spades it is then. Peter's declarer, Tessa, it's you to lead.
Well, this doesn't take a lot of thought. Lead from the top of a sequence. And you can't get better than ace, king, queen, jack.
Ace of diamonds.
So, four spades is the contract. Amanda puts down the dummy. Ace of diamonds led. Now it's up to Peter as declarer to study the two hands and plan his strategy.
Four spades to make, which means we must take 10 tricks. Well, let's start by counting how many I'm likely to lose. Spades first. Ace, king, queen, jack between us. No losers there. Unless, of course, I'm really unlucky and the five missing cards are all with one opponent. Hearts. I have one loser. The ace is missing. Diamonds. I need only lose 2 tricks there, because I can trump as soon as the doubleton in dummy is exhausted. And there's a possible loser in clubs. Four losers, and that's one too many. Now, how can I reduce the 4 losers to 3? Well, I can see 2 possibilities. If the missing hearts are divided 3 and 3 between our opponents, I can discard my 3rd club on dummy's 4th heart. And if that doesn't work, I can still finesse dummy's jack of clubs, hoping that Tessa has the queen. Right, that's the way to play it.
From dummy, the 5 of diamonds. 3 of diamonds. 2 of diamonds.
Ace of diamonds wins. Our trick. King of diamonds.
From dummy, the 6 of diamonds.
8 of diamonds.
4 of diamonds.
King wins. Our trick.
Now, with dummy exhausted of diamonds, leading another isn't going to win a trick. What next? Well, on this holding, a trump can't do any damage.
6 of spades.
From dummy, the 2 of spades.
3 of spades.
7 of spades. 7 wins. My lead. 4 of spades.
8 of spades.
From dummy, the 8 of spades.
5 of spades.
Ace of spades wins. Lead with dummy. 9 of spades.
That's my 2 trumps exhausted, so I must discard.
I discard the 2 of clubs.
King of spades.
10 of spades.
King of spades wins. My lead.
So far, so good. Trumps broke well, 3-2. Now to investigate the heart suit. I wonder if I'll be lucky and have them break 3-3. Well, there's only one way to find out.
3 of hearts.
2 of hearts.
From dummy, the jack of hearts.
The ace of hearts.
Ace of hearts wins. You to lead, partner.
3 tricks we have. Only 1 more needed to defeat their contract. Now, where can we get it? Hearts seem the only possibility. Ace Jack gone, King in dummy. Queen most likely with Peter. But if Tessa has the Queen, my ten will drive out the King.
Ten of hearts.
Queen of hearts.
Seven of hearts.
From dummy, the five of hearts. Queen wins. My lead. Four of hearts.
Nine of diamonds.
From dummy, the king of hearts.
Eight of hearts.
King wins. And the lead's with dummy.
And that's a nuisance. Hearts haven't broken three and three as I'd hoped. Which means that Shaw still has the nine to beat the six in dummy. Well, never mind. On to my second ploy, the finesse. What are the chances of it working? Now think back to the bidding. Tessa opened one diamond, which means she had at least 13 points. And with the ace of hearts in Shaw's hand, she must surely have the queen of clubs to justify her point count. However, lead is with dummy, and I must first get back into my own hand to lead towards the ace jack, a tennis.
From dummy, the eight of clubs.
Four of clubs.
King of clubs.
Six of clubs.
King wins. My lead. Three of clubs.
Ten of clubs.
From dummy, the jack of clubs.
Five of clubs.
You so-and-so. I was absolutely sure the queen was with Tessa, but just for a fleeting second you had me worried. So, once the finesse has worked, I've no more losers with queen of trumps and ace of clubs in dummy. Four spades, bid and made, game and rubber.
Oh, Peter, well played. I must say I was a bit worried when the hearts didn't break, but your gamble on the club finesse worked beautifully.
Well, the main thanks go to you for that informative double. Without that, it would have been very difficult to find a spade fit.
We haven't discussed fully how we can achieve our objectives if your opponents are first to open the bidding. Well, there are six defensive actions that you can take. First, you can overcall in a suit, or in no trumps. You can make a jump overcall, again, either in a suit or in no trumps. Or you can make an informative double, which we've just been discussing and we've seen in operation. You can make a preemptive bid, or you can make a cube bid. But don't let's worry about the last two for the moment. Let's deal with the bread and butter stuff first. An opening bid in a suit or in no trumps has certain requirements which we've discussed at great length. But the requirements for an overcall are even more precise. The most important thing is safety. If you enter the bidding when the opponent on your right has already opened it, it could be that the opponent on your left has strength and already knows that his partner has enough values for an opening bid. So he can easily decide that it's worth doubling you for penalties and take a sizable penalty from you. When you open the bidding, it's a different matter. The opposition hasn't had a chance to communicate and won't be in a position to judge whether it's worth going for penalties. The best way of showing you the difference between opening and overcalling is to give you a for instance. Now, take a look at this hand that I've made up. You'd open on that, wouldn't you? 13 points, evenly balanced. One no trump, maybe. Or, if you're vulnerable and you're playing strong no trump, maybe you'd open one club. But supposing the opponent on the right has already opened one diamond, would you overcall one no trumps or two clubs? Supposing you opted for two clubs and an opponent on your left doubles you, and your partner, who hasn't yet had a chance to say a word, hasn't any values. If you are left in that contract, you're likely to make three tricks. Those three aces, and that's all. And five down, doubled and vulnerable, is a very expensive penalty. 1,400 points, would you believe? So what have you learned from all this? That it's more important to have a good suit with a fair amount of playing strength to overcall than to have a high point count. Far better to have 8 or 9 honour points and a good suit to overcall than, as we've just seen here, 13 points and many possible losers. So let me stress the point that Amanda made. To make an overcall in a suit, you must have at least 5 cards in that suit. Now, the other idea we toyed with was overcalling one no trump. Let's have a look at that hand once again. Well, it's certainly worth an opening bid of one no trumps. But how about an overcall? If you have a good long trump suit, you're protected from a large penalty, but not in no trumps. So before you attempted to overcall in no trumps, remember that you need lots of points. 16 to 18 is the usually accepted standard, same as a strong one no trump opening. And at least one guard in your opponent's suit, preferably 2. And are you still struggling with the rule of probability on how missing cards will divide? You remember, with an odd number of cards in a suit missing, they will probably divide the nearest to even. Let me show you. Thank you, Amanda. Supposing you've got 7 cards in a suit missing, right? They will probably divide 4 and 3. Or, if there are 5 cards missing, probably 3 and 2. Or, just 3 missing, probably 2 and 1. But with an even number of cards missing, they will probably break nearest to even, but not even. Peter, thank you. In other words, supposing you have 10 cards in a suit missing. God forbid you should, but you never know. Now, they will probably divide 6 and 4. Or, 8 missing, divide 5 and 3. 6 missing, probably 4 and 2. Or, just 4 missing, probably 3 and 1. If you want an easy way to remember it, just say odd numbers will divide in your favour and even numbers against it. But for heaven's sake, don't leave out that word probably. A 3-card ending to a hand, all right? That is dummy, and this is you. We won't bother about our 2 opponents for the purposes of this demonstration. Now, what could be easier than cashing these last 3 winners? All you've got to do is lead is in your hand. You lead to the ace with the 2, right? You come back, 3 to the king. Ah, wait a minute, something's gone wrong. Of course, the lead is now back in your hand, and you haven't got a spade to lead to the queen over there. There she sits, stranded. All right, let's just try it again, but let's do it the other way around. This time, let us lead the king first. Right, lead from your hand, the king first, to the 3, in dummy, right. Lead is still in your hand, the 2, to the ace. Now the lead is in dummy, and there she sits in all her glory, ready to take the next trick. There's no con about it, just a simple rule to follow. Play off the high cards first from the hand with the shorter holding, and you should follow that principle even when you're establishing a suit. Now, every once in a while, but not nearly often enough, you'll be dealt a blockbuster. A really strong hand with enough points to go to game with practically no help whatsoever from your partner. Something like this hand here. Now, just take a look at this. Wouldn't you like to be dealt a hand like that? But how do you let your partner know of your good fortune without allowing that tinge of excitement to enter your voice? Well, calm down. There is a bid to suit you. The 2-bid opener. In fact, there are 3 2-bid openers you can make, depending on the type and strength of your hand. You can open the bidding with 2 clubs. A conventional bid that is forcing to gain. 2 of any other suit. Now, that is forcing for 1 round, but it's not insisting on game. Or 2 no trumps, which is not forcing in itself, but any response to it, other than pass, is forcing to game.
The opening bid of two clubs has nothing to do with your club holding. You could have a singleton, you could even have a void. All you are doing is alerting your partner to the fact that you want to play in game, no matter how bad his or her hand may be. And you are inviting your partner to show you some values. If partner has none, the response is as conventional as your opening. Two diamonds. Nothing to do with diamond suit, just nothing to show, a negative response. But supposing he does have something to show, a positive response. Well, the response is completely natural. You've opened two clubs. Partner, show what you have. Two hearts, two spades, two no trumps. Two diamonds, ah. No, you can't do that. That is the conventional negative response. But you can bid three diamonds, or three clubs even, if that's where your strength lies. But hold hard there. What do you need to open with and respond to a conventional two-club opening? Well, for starters, to open two clubs, you need at least 23 honour points. It's a bit odd, I admit, when the agreed partnership holding for game is 26, but bear with me, all will become clear in a moment. So, 23 honour points to open. But we can't measure the positive response requirement in honour points. It's the responder's ability to take quick tricks that matters, and 1.5 is the minimum. But what's a quick trick? I'm glad you asked. It's obvious when you come to think about it. Ace-king in the same suit make two quick tricks. Just the ace would be one quick trick. King-queen in the same suit together make one quick trick. That is, one forces out the ace and the other one makes. Just the king with a low card in the same suit is worth only half a quick trick, because half the time it wins and half the time it loses, depending where the ace is. Nothing like a for instance to hammer home the point. So, my golden guinea pigs, here we go with one of my specially made up hands, and I'm going to ask each of you to respond to my opening bid of two clubs. Peter, if you'd be so kind.
Well, ace-king in different suits makes 1.5 quick tricks. A biddable heart suit, two hearts.
Right on the line, Peter. Tessa, how about you?
Well, I've got the required 1.5 quick tricks with the ace of clubs and the king of diamonds and a biddable suit. But that's in diamonds, and we all know what a two-diamond response is. Negative.
Exactly so, Mum. So what is your positive response?
Three diamonds.
Right. Amanda?
Well, I've already sussed out your little trap for me. Give me a Valentine's hand with all those lovely hearts. 7-4 honours. It's enough to turn a girl's head.
Ah, but is it enough to persuade you to respond two hearts?
No, it's not, Crafty. Because even with all those heart honours, I still can't see 1.5 quick tricks.
So how will you respond?
Negatively. Two diamonds and show my hearts later. After all, your opening is forcing to gain, so I can't stop bidding until we get it. I'll get my chance.
Sensible girl. In fact, if you had responded positively without that essential 1.5 quick tricks, we could have found ourselves out of our depth, even possibly in a slam. Now, one more hand, and this one especially for you. Two clubs I open. What will you respond on this hand? 1.5 quick tricks are there. But where is the biddable suit? Although there are 10 points in a balanced hand. Now, does that give a clue? Right, stand up and take a round of applause, all those who responded two no trumps. You have just shown me a balanced hand and at least 8 points. So, to sum up with the printed word, to burn it into your brain, to open two clubs, you need a minimum of 23 honour points, right? To respond, you need 1.5 quick tricks and a biddable suit. If you haven't got it, go negative, young man, with a conventional artificial bid of two diamonds. If you have got it, show your biddable suit. Majors at the two level, minors at the three. If, however, you have no biddable suit but a balanced hand with a minimum of 8 honour points, respond, two no trumps. Read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest, and wait for the crunch. I have to confess now, there is an exception that proves the rule. A moment when the bidding can stop short of game. If you opened two clubs on this hand, which you're perfectly entitled to do, you count up, you'll see you've got 23 honour points. Two clubs is the right opening. But if partner gives a negative two diamonds response, showing no biddable suit and is without 1.5 quick tricks, in what are you going to find gain? You aren't. So over partner's negative response, you bid two no trumps, showing precisely 23 or 24 points and a balanced hand. But perhaps there were moments when you felt you had more than enough for a one opening, but not the necessary 23 points for a two club opening. In that case, one of our other opening two bids could be the one for you. Two of any other suit other than clubs, that is, or of course two no trumps. Well, let's take the two of any other suit first. It's designed really for the very strong hand where, with just a little help from your partner, you have game values. But partner's help doesn't necessarily mean the 6 points required to respond to a one opening. Open two, and however weak he is, an opening two bid in a suit is forcing for one round. So partner must respond whatever he's holding. Let's have a for instance. On this hand, if your partner opened one spade, you'd pass, wouldn't you? With only 3 points, and quite rightly, too. But if partner was holding this, now your king of diamonds and the Doubleton heart is all he needs to make game. And instead of that, you are stuck in one lousy spade with 3 overtricks. So if this is an ideal two-opener in spades, let's study it a little more closely and analyse what it contains. A total point count of 21. Again, and it's worth repeating, not enough for game without a little help from our friends, partner in other words. What else does it have that is essential to a two of a suit opening? 6 spades. You should have at least 6 cards in the suit you open with. And generally speaking, it would be a self-sufficient suit, one with not more than 1 loser. You should expect to be able to make 8 tricks without any help from partner whatsoever. And you should have 4 defensive tricks. Hello. That's a new one, isn't it? Haven't heard that one before, defensive tricks. Well, don't panic. It's our old friend, the quick trick, the almost dead certainty. Ace, king, ace, etc. So, at least 6 in the suit and 4 defensive tricks, and the opening bid is quite natural, showing the suit that you have strength in. 2 spades in this particular case. Now, just to get your eye in, decide for yourself whether this hand has the qualifications for a 2-diamond opener. What do you think? 6-card suit, 4 defensive tricks with the ace, king of diamonds and the 2 outside aces, 8 playing tricks. I would say so, wouldn't you? So I open 2 diamonds. Right, you've got the general idea of opening 2 of a suit other than clubs. But what about the poor old responder? He is forced to respond whether he has anything or not. Now, the first thing you need is a negative response, one that says loud and clear, I've got very little, maybe nothing. Well, there is a conventional bid to cover just that. Just as the negative response to a 2-club opener is 2 diamonds, so the negative response to 2 of any other suit is 2 no trumps. It doesn't mean you want to play it in no trumps or have a balanced hand or anything like that. It simply means I have little or nothing. On the other hand, if you have something, even, say, 1.5 tricks or 8 or 9 points, you can give a positive response, showing another suit or raising partner's own suit. Remember, he has at least 6 of his opening suits. So it's not so imperative that you have 4 to support him. 3 small ones or a Doubleton honour would do. And by the same token, if he has 8 sure tricks, a positive response from you would be forcing to gain. So, our 3rd possible 2-bid opening. 2 no trumps. Not forcing, partner can pass. Possibly the simplest of all 2-bid openers to judge, because its rules and requirements are very definitely defined. 20 to 22 honour points. Distributional points are of no use in a no-trump contract. A balanced hand with the high cards well shared out. Responding to such an opening is equally straightforward. You know partner's holding to within a couple of points. You know his distribution. Your negative response is quite simple. Pass, no bid. Between us, you are saying, we just do not have enough to go for game. However, if you have 5 points or more, you know you have values for game. It's just a question of the best contract. So, the response is forcing. That is forcing to game. If responder also has a balanced hand, well, then the game is obviously 3-0 trumps. If, however, a long suit suggests that a suit contract would be better, then you respond with 3 of that suit. But beware of 3 clubs. Why? Because our old friend Sam Stamen is still lurking in the wings. You remember Sam, the 2-club man? Well, the Stamen conventional response to a 1-0 trump opening asking partner to show a 4-card major, the same convention can be applied to a 2-0 trump opening. 3 clubs, response, asks for a 4-card major. If the opener hasn't got one, he negatively bids 3 diamonds. If he has, he shows it at the 3 level, still leaving the game contract to be decided. But enough of this lecturing. It's time we got back to our friendly competition. Our third and final rubber in this series. Obviously, neither side is vulnerable, so we are both playing the weak no trump. In other words, 13 or 14 points to open. Amanda, you dealt, so it is you to bid, my love.
Thank you, Shaw. And if I didn't know you better, I think you'd been reading my hand. 4, 7, 9, 10, 12, 13, 14 honour points. No distribution points. And a balanced hand. No question.
1 no trump.
Oh, dear. That's a pity. I've enough points here for an opener myself. 12 honour points. 1 distribution point for the 5th club. But to overcall, I need at least a 5-card suit with a fair amount of playing strength. Well, 5 clubs I have, but I can't say it has playing strength. I'll just have to pass and see if partner has anything.
No bid.
Interesting. Very interesting. Amanda opens 1 no trump, and I'm holding an opening hand myself. 13 honour points, plus 1 for the 5th heart. Enough for game. But in what? No trumps? We may be better off in hearts. But if I show them by bidding 2 hearts, Amanda will assume that it's a weak takeout and pass. However, a jump call in hearts will be forcing to game. It would show at least a 5-card heart suit and leave Amanda to decide whether no trumps or hearts is the best game call. She must have 2 hearts or she wouldn't have opened no trumps. So she can bid 3 no trumps, or if she has more than 2 hearts, she could bid 4 hearts.
3 hearts.
Well, I need hardly bother looking at my hand. 2 miserable points. 1 for the jack and 1 for the 5th heart. Shaw's favourite Lord of the Pasteboard isn't smiling on me at the moment.
No bid.
Thank you, Peter. Game values, at least a 5-card heart suit, in which I hold the King, Queen, Jack. The simplest decision I've had to make in the whole series.
4 hearts.
No bid.
No bid.
No bid. So, me to lead to a 4-heart contract. 10 of clubs. Those should be of some use to you, Peter.
Yes, indeed. A very pleasant sight.
On the face of it. Force out the Ace of Clubs and the King of Diamonds, and there are at least 10 top tricks. But I'm not at all happy about that 10 of Clubs lead. It can't be the 4th highest, and it can't be top of a sequence, as the 9 is in dummy. The most likely reason for leading it is that it's a doubleton, or worse still, a singleton. In which case I'll lose 2 tricks straight away. Shaw must have the Ace of Clubs. And he's bound to lead back a club, which Tessa will trump. What then? Well, she can't get the lead back to Shaw, because I have all the other controls. Ace of Spades, Hearts and Diamonds. So, I'll draw trumps,
and then get rid of my spade loser on Dummy's fourth club. But what if Tessa leads a spade and removes my ace as an entry into Dummy? With five trumps out against me, it may take three or four rounds to draw them, which means I'll have no immediate entry into Dummy, and the club suit will be blocked. Unless...
From Dummy, the four of clubs. Ace of clubs. Queen of clubs.
Ace wins. Our trick. My lead. Eight of clubs.
The king of clubs.
I trump with the three of hearts.
From Dummy, the five of clubs.
Three of hearts wins. Our trick, you to lead, partner.
Next move is to knock out the spade control in Dummy. And that I can try with...
the two of spades.
From Dummy, the ace of spades.
Six of spades.
Four of spades. And the ace of spades wins. Lead with Dummy. From Dummy, the king of hearts.
I discard the two of clubs.
Two of hearts.
And a four of hearts.
The king of hearts wins. Lead still with Dummy.
Oh, that's a nuisance. The missing hearts have broken 5-0. Unusual and unexpected. But now I've unblocked my clubs, it won't affect the final outcome. Just means I have to draw one extra round of trumps.
From Dummy, the Queen of Hearts.
I discard the Seven of Diamonds.
The Five of Hearts.
And the Six of Hearts.
Queen of Hearts wins. And the lead is still with Dummy. From Dummy, the Jack of Hearts.
I discard the Three of Clubs.
And I overtake with the Ace of Hearts.
And the Seven of Hearts.
Ace wins. Now the lead's with my hand.
Four of the five missing hearts have fallen, so we'll have the fifth.
Ten of hearts.
Eight of hearts.
From Dummy, I discard the three of spades.
I discard the seven of clubs.
And ten of hearts wins. Still my lead.
And now to cash my established club winners in Dummy.
Six of clubs.
And I'll discard the five of spades.
From Dummy, the Jack of Clubs.
I discard the Nine of Spades.
And Jack of Clubs wins. Now the lead's with Dummy. From Dummy, the Nine of Clubs.
I discard Queen of Spades.
And I discard the Ten of Spades.
And I'll discard the Eight of Spades.
And the Nine of Clubs wins. Lead still with Dummy.
And having discarded my losing spade 10 on the club 9, I'll take the gamble on the King of Diamonds being a singleton for a possible overtrick.
From Dummy, the Six of Diamonds.
Nine of Diamonds.
Ace of Diamonds.
And the Two of Diamonds.
Ace of Diamonds wins. My lead. Three of diamonds.
Four of diamonds.
From Dummy, the Jack of diamonds.
King of diamonds. King wins. My lead.
Well, don't think too hard, Shaw, because whatever you lead, the last two are mine. The last trump and the master queen. Four hearts, bid and made.
Well, although it grieves me to say it, young Peter, congratulations. With Tessa holding five trumps in a singleton club, you did very well to unblock those clubs in Dummy so you could discard the ten of spades. If you hadn't done that, you'd have gone one down, you know.
Well, I would have done if I hadn't spotted that the king and queen of clubs in my hand would have blocked the clubs in Dummy once trumps were drawn.
Which, of course, is why you dropped your queen of clubs under my ace at the very beginning instead of a six.
Finding all five missing trumps in my hand must have come as a nasty shock.
Well, I wasn't exactly overjoyed to see my king of clubs taken by a small trump. But then it wasn't that surprising after your lead of the ten of clubs.
Just a minute. I don't know what you're all going on about. Four hearts, bid and made is already on my score pad. We're one game up. So, Mr. T, if you'll kindly deal, We'll get on with winning the rubber off you.
You can try, ma'am. You can try. But before I deal, just give me a moment with my good friends over here, because you and I have a little something to chat about. Early on in the series, when talking about opening leads, I said it was conventional to lead from the top of a sequence if you had touching cards, honours preferably. Or, if not touching, a broken suit in other words, lead the fourth highest of that suit. Well, that's the convention, and in the last hand, it was the first time in this series that that convention was broken. And the reason was obvious, of course, because it was a singleton, and Tessa hoped to trump any other club that was played. In fact, she did trump one. But I think it might be helpful for you to know some of the reasons behind the convention. Now, you could write a whole book about this, so let me concentrate on just one reason. The information that it conveys to your partner. Let's take top of a sequence, touching honours first. If you lead with an ace, partner knows that, with rare exceptions, you have the king. If you lead the king, he knows you have the queen, but not the ace, and so on down the line. So, the safest and most reliable opening lead is from the top of a sequence of three or more touching cards, preferably honours. Now, a slight alteration to the pattern. Two-card sequence this time, but it still gives the same information, but not quite as reliable as the three-card sequence, and occasionally, very occasionally, opponent's cards could be arranged in such a way as to cost you a trick. But highest of touching honours is still a good lead. But what about that broken suit that I mentioned? Far more often, you would decide to lead from a suit like this. And here, the conventional lead would be the fourth highest. The five, in fact. But why? Why not the third highest? Or even the lowest? Well, experience has shown that if you always lead fourth highest from a broken suit, and you know that your partner does the same, you will gain far more useful information from that opening lead than with any other system of opening leads. And one of the reasons is the rule of 11. Now, you're not going to believe this, but the rule says this. When the fourth highest card of a suit is led, the total number of higher cards in the other three hands is 11 minus the value of the card. Take away the number first led. There you are. I knew you wouldn't believe me. All right, seeing is believing. Look, I've divided up the heart suit into four hands, as it would be in play, OK? I'm declarer. Tessa is dummy, so dummy's gone down. Now, imagine you are sitting in Amanda's seat over here. It's Peter to lead, so Peter, turn your hand over. And you've got a broken heart suit. Lead your fourth highest. It's the seven. Turn it back again, because Amanda over here can't see what's in your hand. All she can see is what is on the table in dummy. Right, turn your hand over, Amanda. Now, the important thing here, of course, is she wants Peter to keep the lead, so he can keep leading through that king, and then she can take it with the ace. But dare she play underneath this seven? Or have I got a card here to beat it? Well, she works it out by the rule of 11. Remember, seven from 11 leaves four. She knows that there are four cards out in these other three hands that will beat the seven. There's one, she says. There are three more. So that's the four cards that'll beat that seven. She now knows that I can't beat it, so she can afford to play under it. Assuming I play the two from dummy, she plays the three. Is she right or is she wrong? Six and four. I can't beat it. Peter wins the trick. He's still got the lead. He can go on leading through that king until Amanda takes it with the ace. I'm not going to give you another, for instance, because it always works. I don't know why, so please don't ask me. Just take a suit out of a pack of cards and try it out for yourself. Remember, when the fourth highest card of a suit is led, the total number of higher cards in the other three hands is 11 minus the value of the card. Let me impart one last convention to you. It's just for those bridge players who might be watching, who feel that life isn't really complete until the name of Easley Blackwood is mentioned. I don't know where they get these names. He's got to be an American, of course. Well, just like Sam Stamen, Easley was casting around one day for a little-used bid that could be adapted artificially
to make an inquiry, to get a specific bit of information from your partner. And easily Blackwood lighted upon the bid of 4-no-trumps. Well, it's not used a great deal, because 3-no-trumps is enough for game, so who wants to break their neck for another 30 measly points? Aha, said Easley. We could harness that bid to find out how many aces partner has got. If I bid 4-no-trumps, you respond artificially with how many aces you hold. Not which aces, simply how many. If you hold none, you respond 5 clubs. The same if you hold all 4. There could be no misunderstanding here, as the previous bidding will indicate which is which. Now, if you hold 1 ace, you respond 5 diamonds. If you hold 2 aces, you respond 5 hearts. If you hold 3 aces, you respond 5 spades. It's simple to remember because they rise in the same ranking as the suits: clubs, diamonds, hearts and spades. Now, while you study that, you'll appreciate just how useful Blackwood is when you are investigating the possibilities of a small or a grand slam. Now, having discovered how many aces you have between you, you can carry the convention on in the same way to discover kings. 5-no-trumps, following the response to 4-no-trumps, is asking partner to enumerate his kings. It's the same again. None or 4, he bids 6 clubs. 1, bid 6 diamonds. If you hold 2 kings, you bid 6 hearts. If you hold 3 kings, you bid 6 spades. From your holding, it immediately becomes crystal clear whether the club bid means you've got none or you've got all 4 kings. Logically, of course, you wouldn't be inquiring about kings unless you were assured that you hold all 4 aces between you, because already you're committed to 6 tricks and probably heading for a grand slam. Now, isn't that a honey? Can you wonder that Easley Blackwood's bright idea became a full-blooded convention? There are a couple of others, like cue bidding and the Nunes Grand Slam Force, thought up by our own Uncle Jack, but that's for another place at another time. Right now, it's my deal, I think. And with Peter and Amanda one game up in the last rubber, we have some very serious bridge to play. So if partner and I are to win the session, we need to do a little levelling up.
And I am sitting with just the sort of hand that might do it, a possible 2-opener. Now, let's check it out against the requirements that I mentioned and see if I'm right. 6 cards, at least, in the suit I open with. No problem there. 6 spades I have. But can I see 8 playing tricks? In other words, make 8 tricks without any help at all from my partner? Well, it would be really unlucky distribution if the Jack of Spades didn't fall to Ace, King or Queen. So, assuming 6 spades plus the Ace, King of Hearts, that's my 8. Now, what was the other thing? Oh, yes, 4 defensive tricks, or quick tricks. Ace, King, Ace, King. Right, lad, here you go.
2 spades.
Hello, hello. Shaw's finding his feet. Let's see what I've got. 9 honours points plus 2 for distribution. Well, with Shaw showing a strong hand, I'd be balmy to risk an overcall that could end up with us copping a big penalty, and at the 3 level. I don't want to bust up a beautiful friendship.
No bid.
Well, partner's opening 2 bids sounds promising. I just wish I could be more enthusiastic myself. But on this lot, it isn't easy. A grand total of 6 points. Huh. In fact, even if partner had opened 1 spade, I'd have passed. But a 2-bid is forcing for 1 round. I mustn't pass. So a negative response would seem to be the order of the day.
2 no-trumps.
No bid from Peter. And I can't do any better. 10 honours points. No distribution points. In fact,
no bid.
Not exactly the enthusiastic response I would have liked. Let's review the situation. I don't need a lot from partner, just a few values. And I'd hardly want to play this hand in no trumps. And I've got to speak again anyway. So, can't do any harm to show my 2nd suit.
3 hearts.
No bid.
Ho, ho. Two spades, three hearts. And I've three low cards in each suit. But Shaw should have at least six of his first suit. So I'm going to have to put him back into spades. But at what level? If I make a simple preference bid of three spades, he'll probably pass, particularly after my negative 2-0 trump response. And yet I have got the ace of clubs. And my Doubleton diamond could be useful with three small spades to trump if I have to. Would he misinterpret a jump bid of four spades and start looking for slams? No, of course not. That 2-0 trump negative response would show we're not in that league.
Four spades. No bid.
No bid?
No bid.
Right, three no bids in a row. Means that we are in a contract of four spades, and Peter, you are to lead.
No difficulty here. Touching on us, lead the highest.
King of clubs.
Well, I hope you like them, partner.
Ten tricks I must make. Three losers I can afford. Let's see. Nine trumps between us. No losers there, I hope. I must lose one heart, possibly two. No losers in clubs, with a singleton in my hand and the ace in dummy. But two certain losers in diamonds. Oh, dear, no. I can't afford that. If I'm to make this contract, I've got to save a trick somewhere. And that can only be in hearts. If the missing six hearts divide 3-3, I'm all right. I'll be left with the 13th as master. But the old rule says they're likely to break nearest to even, but not even. In other words, 4-2. Same with trumps. Four outstanding. And if I can draw them in two rounds, I'll have a trump left in dummy to rough a heart if they don't break even. Yes, but what if I play two rounds of trumps and find that the law of averages has triumphed yet again and the trumps break 3-1? Oh, dear, I can see what would happen then. When I play the third heart, our opponents will win it and still have an outstanding trump to draw the one still in dummy. And bang goes my chances of trumping the fourth heart. Right. Let's look on the dark side. Let's expect a 4-2 break in hearts and a 3-1 break in trumps. Now, is there any way of getting home in that situation? Yes, I think there is. It's just a question of timing. So long as all the outstanding trumps are not in one hand.
From Dummy. Ace of clubs.
Nine of clubs.
Seven of clubs. Ace wins. Our trick. Lead is with dummy. From dummy. Two of spades.
Seven of spades.
Ace of spades.
Nine of spades.
Ace of spades wins. My lead.
Right. That's the first hurdle over. The trumps are not divided 4-0. Now, before we draw any more trumps, let's have a look at hearts. I've got to lose one. So the answer is to lose it now. It would be stupid to play the ace-king and have them take control on the third round. They might be able to lead a fourth round of hearts, which the other opponent could trump if they have two trumps each. So, lose the heart now and keep control.
Three of hearts.
Five of hearts.
From dummy, the two of hearts.
Nine of hearts. Nine of hearts wins our trick. My lead. King of diamonds.
Four of diamonds.
The seven of diamonds.
From dummy, the nine of diamonds.
King of diamonds wins. Queen of diamonds.
Eight of diamonds.
Two of diamonds.
And from dummy, the Jack of Diamonds.
Queen of Diamonds wins. Still my lead.
And with dummy's diamonds exhausted, there's not much future in going on with those. Peter led the King of Clubs, so should have the Queen. Ace is gone. So,
Two of Clubs.
I trump with a ten of spades.
Five of clubs.
From dummy, the three of clubs. Ten of spades wins. Our trick, my lead.
Now I can afford to test trumps once again. Two still outstanding. Have the gods smiled on me and given one to each opponent? In which case, with both drawn, I'll have one left in dummy to trump my small heart if need be.
King of spades.
I discard the three of diamonds.
From dummy, the three of spades.
Eight of spades.
King of spades wins. Our trick, my lead.
So the gods don't smile on me. Still one trump outstanding, the jack. And that's with Amanda. Well, thank heavens I don't have to lose the lead now and let her draw dummy's last trump before I can test the heart suit. Now, I can see if the hearts will break in my favour, 3-3. And if they don't, I still have the chance that it is Amanda who's sitting with four of them and won't be able to over-trump dummy because she'll have to follow suit. Right, here we go, my lucky lads.
Ace of hearts.
Eight of hearts.
From dummy, the four of hearts.
Ten of hearts.
Ace wins. Our trick. My lead. King of hearts.
I discard the five of diamonds.
From dummy, the six of hearts.
Jack of hearts.
King of hearts wins. My lead.
And I can hardly wait. It's worked. Magic. Amanda has the outstanding trump. But poor darling, she's also got the other heart. And that means she'll have to follow suit as I lead my last losing heart and then trump it with dummy's five of spades.
Seven of hearts.
I discard the six of diamonds.
I trump from dummy with the five of spades.
Queen of hearts.
Five of spades wins. The lead is with dummy. From dummy, the four of clubs.
Jack of clubs.
I trump with the four of spades.
Ten of clubs.
Four of spades takes the trick. And I will draw your jack with my queen, Amanda, which gives me the last two tricks. And as I've only lost one heart and two diamonds, four spades, bid and made. So I'm also going to give myself 100 honours points because I held the ace, king, queen, ten of trumps. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I slip that one in? 100 for honours. Wow. It's just a little bonus that you might be dealt from time to time. Four or five honours in one hand, or in a no-trump contract, four aces, and you deserve a little something extra, like 100 or 150-point bonus. Everybody gets it, declarer or defender, whether a contract is made or not. Now, the critical rubber is in the balance. Peter, you dealt, you the bid, son.
Thanks, Dad.
16 honour points and a balanced hand. We're vulnerable, so partner and I are playing the strong no trump, 16 to 18 points to open. If it's right into the slot.
One no trump.
So, the bidding is opened. Nothing to say with this lot. Five to the Queen of Spades and five to the Jack of Clubs. Three honours points and a couple of distribution points. No, thank you.
No bid.
We're vulnerable, so we're now playing a strong no trump. Peter has opened with a no trump, so he must have 16 to 18 points. And here am I with an opening no trump hand myself. 16 honour points and fairly balanced. Well, if he hadn't got in first, I'd have opened one no trump. However, what do I respond? A fit in hearts would be interesting. And there's one way to find out if Peter has any. Our old friend Stamen. Two clubs.
Oh, dear. I'm not mad about this at all. Either their bidding or my hand. Six diamonds to the jack. Five on a point. Ain't nothing you can do there, Jim Lad, except pass.
No bid.
So, Amanda's made a stamen bid. She's asking me if I have a four-card major. Well, I have both. So, bid up the line. Hearts first.
Two hearts.
No bid.
I like it. I like it. If partner has a four-card heart suit, we'll play in hearts. And that gives me an extra point for my Doubleton club. 17 total points. Now, hang about there. If partner opened on the minimum, we have 33 points between us, but maximum 35. Well, let's take the average 34. That's in the small slam zone, 12 tricks. Oh, should I bid a small slam straight away? Patience, Amanda. If partner opened on 16 honour points, and I have 16, that's 32 honour points between us. 40 in the pack, 8 missing. And that 8 could mean 2 aces. I think a little more investigation, my dear Holmes, before committing ourselves. 3 cheers for Easley Blackwood. 4 no trumps.
No bid.
Fantastic, she's gone to Blackwood. How many aces have I got? Now, what is it? Clubs for none or 4? Diamonds for 1. Diamonds it is.
5 diamonds.
No bid.
Peter has 1 ace. I have 2. 1 missing. So there's no point in pressing on with Blackwood to find out about kings. With an ace out against us, we're definitely not looking for a grand slam.
6 hearts.
No bid.
No bid.
No bid.
And 3 no bids in a row puts Miracle Man in the hot seat yet again. You do realise what your hero worship is doing to this young lad, don't you?
Of course I do. But I rather think it's due to the perfection of our bidding and play.
Oh. I think you better leave, partner, before I get a small slam in the right ear.
Leave it to me, partner.
Well, the lead's fairly obvious. My singleton diamond. If Shaw has the ace and returns the suit, I can trump and sink 'em before they've had time to turn round. Unlikely. But not impossible. I've seen it happen before.
8 of diamonds.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much, Amanda.
12 tricks to make, so we can only afford 1 loser. Trumps are solid. Ace, king, queen, jack between us. Ace of clubs is missing, so we lose 1 trick there. Diamonds? No losers. Ace, king, queen between us, and I only have a doubleton. But spades, that's quite a different matter. With the queen missing, the whole contract is going to depend on not losing a spade. But I have a finesse position. In fact, having the 10 as well as the jack, I have a two-way finesse. In other words, I can finesse against north or south. But which way? Who has the queen, Shaw or Tessa? Nothing in the bidding to help me. So, the answer is to play everything else except spades and see what clues I can pick up as we go. A little trump drawing, I think, as soon as I'm in.
From dummy, the 3 of diamonds.
9 of diamonds.
King of diamonds. King wins, my lead. King of hearts.
2 of hearts.
From dummy, the 4 of hearts.
6 of hearts.
King of hearts wins. My lead.
Queen of hearts.
3 of hearts.
From dummy, the 8 of hearts.
9 of hearts.
Queen of hearts wins. My lead.
4 down, 1 to go. Luck seems to be holding.
5 of hearts.
2 of clubs.
From dummy, the ace of hearts.
10 of hearts.
Ace of hearts wins. Lead with dummy.
So, Shaw had the other heart. That's worth remembering. Now to clear that nasty ace of clubs.
From dummy, the queen of clubs.
Ace of clubs.
4 of clubs.
5 of clubs.
Ace of clubs wins. My lead.
Now, we have the one trick we need. Only one more to defeat their contract. But what to lead now? Well, not much choice but to play back clubs.
10 of clubs.
King of clubs.
6 of clubs.
From dummy, the 7 of clubs. King wins. My lead.
I said I'd stay away from spades until the last, and that's exactly what I'm going to do. So, might as well trump my last club with dummy's last trump.
8 of clubs.
9 of clubs.
And I trump with the jack of hearts.
3 of clubs.
Jack wins, and the lead's with dummy. From dummy, the ace of diamonds.
2 of diamonds.
5 of diamonds.
I can't follow suit, so I'll discard the 3 of spades.
Ace of diamonds wins. Lead with dummy.
Very interesting indeed. Tessa had a singleton diamond, which gives the sinister Shaw 6 of them. Again, well worth remembering.
From dummy, the queen of diamonds.
4 of diamonds.
I can't follow suit, so I discard the 5 of spades.
Nor can I, so I'll discard the 4 of spades.
Queen of diamonds wins. Lead with dummy.
Well, the agony is nearly over. All I need is a little bit of luck. One more diamond to come from dummy to fall to my lurking trump.
From dummy, the 6 of diamonds.
7 of diamonds.
And I trump with the 7 of hearts.
And as I can't follow suit, I'll discard the jack of clubs.
My trump wins. My lead. 9 tricks we have. 3 more we need.
And we're down to the last 3 cards. To make them all, I have to finesse. I've got to pick up the missing queen of spades. To do that, I can play a small spade to dummy. And if Tessa has the queen, play the 10, which must win because I have the ace jack. Or I can play a small spade to dummy's king and lead a small one back to finesse the jack if Shaw has the queen. But which one has it? Well, we'll soon find out. I'll leave my ace, and if my calculations are right, Shaw only holds a singleton spade. And if that's the lovely lady, she will fall. If not, well, next time round I lead through Tessa to finesse the 10.
Ace of spades.
8 of spades.
From dummy, the 2 of spades.
7 of spades.
Ace of spades wins. My lead.
So, Shaw's only spade is a 7. Tessa holds the queen. Finesse the 10, and the king takes her.
6 of spades.
9 of spades.
From dummy, the 10 of spades, which has to win, Shaw, because you have no more spades.
I think you've been peeking. Well, if you're going to play it like that, I'll discard the 10 of diamonds.
And I'm quite sure, Tessa, you will allow your lovely queen to be taken by my king. One small slam, bid and made, game and rubber. Thank you very much.
Peter, you're wonderful.
Well, I wouldn't say wonderful. Crafty, maybe. Ooh. Clever, even. All right, mastermind, how did you know which way to finesse? How did you know I had a singleton spade?
Just by counting. You followed to 3 rounds of trumps and 3 rounds of clubs, right, including the one I trumped in dummy. Now, Tessa's opening lead was a diamond, but when she couldn't follow diamonds on the second round, I knew the opening lead had to be a singleton, which meant that you had 6 of them. 3 trumps, 3 clubs, 6 diamonds, which makes 12, leaving one more, which had to be a spade. Unless you happen to be playing with 14 cards.
I got a feeling Uncle Jack Nunes has been giving you private lessons. All right, partner, what should we score them for that?
Well, I make a small slam, vulnerable, bid and made, game and rubber, 1,430 points. 180 for the six hearts at 30 points, a trick. 750 for the small slam, vulnerable. And 500 for a three-game rubber.
I don't know what you're smiling at. I've just worked out that over the three rubbers we've played on this session, these two have won 7 points, 700 in other words, and at 10 pence a 100, that's 70 pence each we owe them. And I wrote the script. I must be mad. Meanwhile, from Amanda.
Goodbye.
From Tessa.
Goodbye.
From Peter.
Goodbye.
Special goodbye from Uncle Jack Nunes and from me. Goodbye and good bridge. Bye-bye. Right, you three. Come on. I think you deserve a break.
Oh,
I might even be forced to go on buying your drink.
Oh, that can't be bad.
Same. So where did we go wrong, partner?
Well, I'm not too sure, I mean.